Love in a Mist. By Ashenafi. Montage, London. A quick take of the City of London, Tower Bridge and London Eye, City of London, Palace of Westminster, Buckingham Palace, Kew Gardens, Westminster Abbey, St. Margaret's Church, Piccadilly Circus, St. Paul's Cathedral, Tower Bridge and Trafalgar Square, the royal family on the balcony of Buckingham Palace at the annual Trooping the Colour and many more. Montage, Vivian. Fashion runway, we see models walking on the runway, tall, sexy, and gorgeous. Camera lights flash from every angle. On the soundtrack, music plays. Then comes a very attractive girl named Vivian Parker, 24, and strikes poses. She is around 5.6 like Kate Moss, not as tall as the other models, but extremely beautiful and sensual. Millions of camera lights flash at her. Vogue photo studio, Vivian poses for a photographer. The photographer takes series photos of Vivian. Magazine stand, Vivian is on the covers of Vogue magazines. Wimbledon tennis. The paparazzi takes photos of Vivian and Prince John, Duke of Buckingham, 33, as they come to attend Wimbledon. Bizarre photo shot, Vivian poses in the beach. Another photographer takes her pictures. Bizarre headquarter. We see the photo of Vivian in larger-than-life frame at Bizarre Fashion Magazine headquarter. Int. Restaurant, night. It is a fancy five-star restaurant. Vivian, who is wearing a bewitching black Christian Dior gown, sits at a table with a glass of wine. On the stage, Maya sings Adele's Someone Like You. We see a couple of young and wealthy customers sitting at tables and enjoying their outings. Vivian takes a sip and looks at her watch. Then at the entrance, Prince John walks in. He comes behind Vivian and kisses her on the cheek. John, hi. Vivian, under her breath, hey. John pulls a chair and sits in front of Vivian. John, I'm sorry. I'm late. I got caught up at the hospital. Vivian, it's all right. I can live with a man who arrived 5 minutes late, as long as he makes it up for me. John, they raised me to be a king. But I can't go to hospitals and visit sick children. They break my heart. How much they train you, nothing really prepares you for reality. Vivian has no comment. John, anyway, I know you hate sad stories as much as I do. But I need a woman like you to walk me through the valley of life and bring joy to my soul. Vivian, humorously, what makes you think I can walk you through the valley of life and bring joy to your soul? John, because you're the most beautiful woman in the world. I can walk through the fire in hell, just thinking of the snowflakes in your eyes. Vivian, that's quite a compliment. But I didn't know they taught you to be Romeo in royal school. John, you have no idea what you are getting yourself. Out of nowhere, John produces a diamond ring, goes down with his one knee. John, will you marry me? Vivian isn't surprised at all, as if she knew it was coming. Vivian, yes. Everybody in the restaurant claps his and her hands in celebration, making all kinds of joyous noises. They are on it. That surprises Vivian somehow. John places the ring on Vivian's middle finger. They kiss. The crowd make more noise. The main waiter opens a champagne, pours the champagne into two separate glasses, and places them in front of Vivian and Prince John. John and Vivian take the champagne. John, cheers. Vivian, cheers. They connect their glasses and take sips. On the stage, Maya begins to sing Rolling in the Deep by Adele. The crowd sing Rolling in the Deep with Maya in harmony, as if they were in Wembley Football Stadium watching soccer. John gives Vivian his hand to dance. She takes his hand. They come to the dance floor and dance slow. Vivian, who are all these people? John, they're my friends that I play football with, you know Mark. John points at Mark, 33. Mark waves his hand, greeting. Vivian returns his greeting and says hi under her breath. Vivian, how come I didn't see him? John, he was hiding in the kitchen. There is a silent moment. The crowd continue to sing Rolling in the Deep harmoniously. Close up, John and Vivian. Vivian, humorously, did you stage this, Your Majesty? John, playing along, I'm only a prince, Your Highness. I don't know anything about engagement. It was Mark's idea. Vivian, tell him he did a fantastic job. John, sure. There is another silent moment. She then. Vivian, under her breath, I adore you. John, I adore you too. They kiss. Everybody claps, making cheering noises. Montage. Vivian is on the cover of People magazine with Prince John, titled The Princess Bride. Vivian and Prince John are in the cover of Time, titled, The Most Influential People in the Planet. Vivian poses for a photographer named Calvin in the garden. Calvin takes her pictures. Vivian is on the cover of Vanity Fair. Vivian and Prince John come to Vanity Fair party. Hundreds of paparazzi photograph them. Vivian seems glam. She gives us the most beautiful smile. Fade to, black. Love in a Mist. Fade in. Int. Mansion, Vanity Fair party, day. We see elites, aristocrats, producers, movie stars, and models standing with glasses of champagnes and mingling. It is hosted by Amanda, Vivian's best friend, and Vanity Fair. We see Amanda, 25, editor of Vanity Fair, talking to actor Nicholas Hoult. Then at the entrance, Prince John and Vivian, who is wearing a breathtaking red Valentino gown, walk in. Amanda looks at them. She excuses Nicholas and walks toward them. Vivian and John greet some of the guests with nods as they move down the room. Vivian sees Amanda as she approaches them. She comes up to them. Amanda, hi. Vivian, hi. They hug and kiss on the cheeks. Amanda, to John, what's up? John, under his breath, nothing much. Amanda and John kiss on the cheeks, greeting. Amanda, I thought you weren't going to show up. John, what make you think that? Amanda, she told me you were planning to go to a ski trip in Italy. John, she changed her mind at the last minutes. Vivian, someone told the paparazzi where we were going to stay before we even packed our stuffs. It was in the tabloids. Amanda, anyway. Come on. Let me introduce you to Nicholas Hoult. John, Vivian, and Amanda walk toward Nicholas Hoult. Amanda, he's just cast as Wesley in the Princess Bride remake. It's your favorite movie of all time. I always thought he looks like Cary Elwes, the actor who played Wesley in the original The Princess Bride movie. On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously. Amanda, Vivian, and John come up to Nicholas Hoult. Amanda introduces Vivian and John to Nicholas Hoult. They all greet. A waiter comes by with a tray of champagnes. Amanda stops him. She takes a champagne. The waiter offers them champagnes. John grabs a glass, so does Vivian and Nicholas. The waiter walks away. John, Vivian, Amanda, and Nicholas Hoult talk while sipping champagnes. Hint. Mansion, Vanity Fair party, later. John and Vivian stand by the bar, talking while sipping champagnes. The guests continue to have good time. Miley Cyrus is present at the party. She is wearing a red translucent Versace gown that shows her entire bodies. John, do you think it's appropriate for all female celebrates to take their clothes off and show certain parts of their bodies, like Miley Cyrus? I doubt she's wearing any underwear. Vivian, women have come so far from being housewives and just giving birth to a boy to successful individuals who give rise to ideas that allow humanity to flourish in all aspects of life, and define the vital principle of the free world, and they are not afraid to express their sexuality. I think their freedom means everything. John looks at Miley Cyrus again. John, humorously, I must agree with you. They have come so far. You could say she is the daughter of a woman. Vivian, are you turned on by her? John, I can't answer that. Vivian, why can't you answer that? John, if I say, no, you'll think I'm a liar. If I say, yes, you'll think I'm a pervert. Vivian, so, which is it? Are you a pervert, or a liar? John, do you want me to be honest about it? Vivian, honesty is one of the greatest characters that not only can a man possess without getting caught up in superficiality, but also count on when things seem either deceptive or ordinary and untrue, which he also has to master the art of flirting without being too obvious. John, in that case, I can't control my instinct. The bloods in my veins have their own cognization, tending to overreact toward naked dresses, or rather be predispositioned to respond to the slightest touch of nudity. Vivian, that means you have a hard on. John smiles in amusement. He puts his drink aside. John, dance. He gives her his hand to dance. She puts her drink on the table and takes his hand. They come up to the dance floor and begin to dance slow. John, what makes you think I have a hard on? Vivian, I am told when blood flows a certain part of male's anatomy, it tends to get hard. John, can you be more specific? What is a certain part of my anatomy? Vivian, your penis. John smiles big. John, for Christ's sake. I'm a prince. I'll be the king of the United Kingdom someday. You'll be a queen. We can't talk about this kind of stuff in public. People might be recording us. Vivian, if you say so, Your Excellency. I just thought you might be interested in threesome, with Miley Cyrus. John, is that right? Vivian, I can arrange it. John smiles in amazement. John, are you testing me? Vivian, what do you think? There is a silent moment. John looks deep into her eyes. He then. John, I desire no woman but you. He gives her a soft kiss on the nose. Vivian is taken by Prince John's romantic move. But she plays it cool as they continue to dance slow. A sequence of photo shots of John and Vivian as they continue to dance. Note, we don't know who is taking the pictures. Hint. Supermarket, day. Vivian shops at a local supermarket, grabbing everything and putting them in a shopping cart. Out of nowhere appear two paparazzi, Jake and Luke, and begin to take her pictures. Vivian doesn't like it. But she tries her best to ignore them. Jake, how do you feel to be the future Queen of England? Vivian, no comment. Luke, you've got to have an opinion, Your Highness. She says nothing. They continue to take her pictures. Vivian, you are invading my privacy. Jake, acting wise, it comes with the territory. You're one of most famous persons in the world. Luke, more famous than the man you're about to marry. They continue to take her pictures. Vivian can't take it anymore. Vivian, that's enough. You are getting on my nerves. Jake, sorry, Your Highness. Do you have any idea how much these photos are worth? British and American tabloids pay thousands of pounds for each snapshot. Luke, there is yen to be made as well. Don't be surprised if you get mobbed in Tokyo. The Japanese pay even more. They continue to photograph her. Vivian, if you won't stop, I'll call the securities. Luke, don't be naive. It's the securities who called us in the first place. They continue to take her pictures. Vivian tries to ignore them, which is impossible to do at this point. She is infuriated. But these guys are pro. They make living out of taking photos of celebrities. They'd love to get some kinds of reaction here. Yet Vivian controls her emotion as they continue to take her pictures as if they were looking at an angel from the highest order of heavens. Jake, just pretends as if we were not here. Luke, but give us your best smile once in a while. Thinks of Shakespeare's sonnet 16 Shall I compare thee the summer days? They keep photographing her. Vivian grabs half dozen banana and puts it in her shopping cart. Luke, peel a banana and take a bite. Jake, there is nothing sexier than a woman eating a banana. It's all men's sexual fantasy. Vivian is pissed. Vivian, I swear, guys, stop it. I'll call the police. You're harassing me. Out of nowhere comes actor Henry Cavill. Henry, to Vivian, hi. I'm Henry Cavill. Vivian, hi. Henry, are these guys bothering you? Vivian, they won't leave me alone. They keep taking my pictures. Luke, look who's here. Henry Cavill. They take his picture as well. Henry, cut it off. They continue to photograph Vivian and Henry Cavill together. Henry, I said cut it off. Henry snatches the camera from Jake and throws it away. Jake, what the fuck's wrong with you, dude? Jake picks up his camera. Jake, this camera cost more than your stupid brain, stupid. Henry grabs Jake by his throat like a tiger. Henry, what the fuck did you said, motherfucker? Jake, I called you stupid, brainless, stupid. Henry, I'll snatch out your throat. Don't fuck with me, dickhead. Henry squeezes Jake's neck. Vivian comes between them. Vivian, it's okay. They do this for a living. They get you mad and photograph you. Luke continues to take their picture. Henry clamps down. Henry, to Jake I should break your neck and eat your heart uncooked, motherfucker. Henry lets him go. Jake, you're right, tough guy. You can't even eat a rabbit heart if they bring roasted. Jake looks at his camera. Jake, I can't believe you broke my camera. He broke it? You fucking broke it? Jake is making a scene. People have already stopped what they were doing and watching them in wonder. Vivian, I'll pay for the damage. Let's not get carried away. Jake, it's easy for you to say that. I photographed the Queen and Harry Styles with this camera. It's irreplaceable. Henry takes out a chunk of money. Henry, get yourself a new camera. Henry throws the money at Jake like Sonny in The Godfather Part 1. Henry, just leave her alone. She is a human being. Respect her wishes. Two store securities, Roger and Ted, arrive at the scene. Security 1, Roger, what's going on? Henry, these guys are bothering her, taking photographs. Roger, guys, leave the store now. You can't be harassing our customers. Luke, we're not harassing them, Raj. Just doing our jobs. The paparazzi know the securities very well. Ted, security 2, just leave. We don't want to get fired. The securities escort them outside. The crowd break off. Vivian looks at Henry's eyes. There is a silent moment. She then. Vivian, thanks for standing up for me. Henry, think nothing of it. They are assholes. Excuse my language. It is not right. You are an attractive woman. I mean, a princess. You should be treated with some respect and dignity. Vivian, I'm not a princess. John and I are only engaged. But thanks. We can't let them get into our heads. Henry, sensing what she meant by I'm sorry. I lost it. He called me stupid. Vivian, it's okay. You don't have to apologize to me. I would have snatched out his throat if I were as strong as you. They share small smiles. Henry, anyway. I have to be somewhere. Pleased to meet you. Vivian, likewise. I'm a big fan of your movies. They kiss on the cheeks. Paparazzi 3, who's hiding at flower section, photographs them. He snaps the pictures of Vivian and Henry as they exchange kisses on the cheeks and more. On the soundtrack, music plays. Vivian and Henry have few more words and go their separate ways. EXT magazine stand, day. We see photos of Vivian and Henry on the covers of British tabloids, titled, Vivian Caught in Act, Is Vivian Having an Affair with Actor Henry Cavill? Meet the new man in Vivian's life, Is this the biggest scandal in the history of UK? Etc. Vivian, who is wearing a sunglass and a blonde wig, and happens to be passing by, looks at the tabloids. She stops and grabs a copy. Vivian gives the clerk £20 and tells him to keep the change. Vivian flips the magazine and sees the article. There are pictures of Vivian and Henry in the main pages. Montage, London. A quick take of the City of London, Tower Bridge and London Eye, City of London, Palace of Westminster, Buckingham Palace, Kew Gardens, Westminster Abbey, St. Margaret's Church, Piccadilly Circus, St. Paul's Cathedral, Tower Bridge and Trafalgar Square and many more. Int. Tina Coffee Shop, day. Amanda sits at a table with a cup of coffee and a muffin. At the entrance, Vivian, wearing a red wig and a fake eyeglass, walks in. Amanda sees Vivian and waves her hand. Vivian comes up to the table. Vivian, hi. Amanda, what's up? They kiss on the cheeks. Vivian pulls a chair and sits in front of Amanda. Vivian, Did you get the ticket?
Amanda, yes, I did.
Amanda gives Vivian a plane ticket. Vivian places it in her purse. Vivian, what did Kevin say?
Amanda, he said he would pick us up at the Rouen airport. We'll drive from Rouen to Paris.
It's a 3-hour drive. Neither Royal Guard nor paparazzi will trace our flight record. They won't know where we're staying in Paris.
EXT airplane, flying, day.
Airplane flies in the air.
Int.
Airplane, day. Amanda and Vivian sit in the first class.
Amanda, are you sure we know what we're doing?
Vivian, I just want to get away for a few weeks.
My life doesn't have to evolve around the paparazzi.
Amanda, did you say few weeks?
Vivian, 4 weeks.
Vivian, I thought we're only going away for 3 days.
Vivian, I changed my mind.
I need some time alone.
Amanda, you just can't disappear for a month without telling anybody. They might think someone kidnapped you.
Vivian, I'll call John and tell him I'm not kidnapped.
But I won't tell him where I am.
Amanda, playing along, you're the princess. It's your life. Do whatever you want to do with it.
I'm just tagging along.
Vivian, why everybody keeps saying I'm a princess?
John and I are only engaged.
We are not planning to get married anytime soon.
I can still have fun as a single woman.
On the soundtrack, music plays.
EXT airplane, flying, day.
Airplane flies in the air.
EXT Rouen International Airport, terminal, day.
A young man named Kevin stands at the terminal.
Vivian and Amanda come to the terminal, pulling their luggage.
Kevin sees them and waves his hand.
Both Amanda and Vivian look at him, smile in joy, and walk up to him.
Amanda and Kevin hug and kiss on the lips like lovers.
Kevin and Vivian cuddle and kiss on the cheeks, greeting.
They talk a little bit and begin to walk toward the exit, conversing.
We don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack.
Int. BMW convertible, moving, day.
Kevin is behind the wheel.
Amanda sits in the passenger seat.
Vivian sits in the back.
They drive in the evergreen part of France.
EXT BMW convertible, moving, day.
An established shot of the BMW convertible with Kevin, Amanda, and Vivian as they continue to drive in the streets of France.
Montage, Paris.
The Eiffel Tower, Café Les Deux Magots in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, skyscrapers of La Défense, Notre-Dame de Paris, the city of Paris, panoramic view of the Isle Saint-Louis, the Place de la Concorde, Avenue de Champs-Élysées, Seine River, Paris bridges and many more.
Int.
Clausel Hotel, day.
Vivian, Amanda, and Kevin walk in.
In the meantime, a bellboy, who is pushing Vivian and Amanda's luggage and bags with a hotel cart, enter the hotel.
The bellboy stands at the entrance.
Vivian, Amanda, and Kevin walk down the lobby and come up to the circulation desk.
Two clerks are in the circulation desk.
Kevin, bonjour.
Clerk 1, bonjour.
Kevin, in French I called yesterday and made a reservation.
Clerk 1, in French your name, please.
Kevin, Kevin Jones.
The clerk looks at a file.
He finds Kevin's name, grabs a key.
Clerk 1, in French room 406.
Clerk 1 gives Kevin the key.
Kevin takes the key.
Kevin, in French that's my lucky number.
Kevin, Vivian, and Amanda walk toward the elevator.
On the soundtrack, music comes.
Montage, Paris.
The Eiffel Tower, Café Les Deux Magots in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, skyscrapers of La Défense, Notre Dame de Paris, the city of Paris in the night, panoramic view of the Isle Saint-Louis as the sun rises, the Place de la Concorde, Avenue de Champs-Élysées in the middle of the day, Seine River, Paris bridges and many more.
Int.
Florence Art Show, night.
Breathtaking artistic paintings and portraits of nude women are in display.
The guests are having fun.
Some are looking at the paintings.
Others mingle while drinking wines and enjoying refreshments.
Amanda and Vivian look at the paintings while sipping wines.
The paintings are exhilarating.
We can't tell if they are photographs, or paintings.
Vivian is awestruck by the paintings.
The artist Florent Raphael, 34, converses with two gorgeous models while checking out Vivian.
On the soundtrack, French song plays melodiously.
Vivian, did he really paint them?
They look like photographs.
Amanda, they must be computer-generated photos.
They continue to look at the paintings.
They stop at a galvanizing painting, a nude girl and an angel making out with kiss.
Vivian, this can't be real.
Amanda, it's a photograph.
Vivian, I doubt it.
Where did he get that angel?
Amanda, you'd be surprised how some artists go to great lengths to be famous.
I saw an art gallery show 2 years ago in Rome.
I thought the paintings were real.
But they said the artist staged everything.
He hired amateur actors, dressed them up with costumes and photographed them, like some kind of low-budget Hollywood movie.
Later, he confessed everything.
Vivian looks at the painting thoughtfully.
Vivian, I want to meet him, the artist.
Amanda, he's over there talking to those girls.
Vivian turns her eyes and looks at Florent, who is conversing with the models.
Florent catches her eyes, and gives her a wink.
She gives him a beautiful smile, but turns away in shyness.
On the soundtrack, music plays a little bit louder.
Vivian and Amanda continue to talk.
Florent continues to mingle with the models while checking out Vivian.
Vivian turns her eyes and looks at Florent, who catches her eyes again. Vivian gives him another beautiful smile. But this time, she plays it cool, turns her eyes with confidence.
Hint.
Florence art show, later. The guests continue to mingle. Vivian stands alone with a glass of wine, looking at a nude portrait of a young woman with the stigmata of Christ. On the soundtrack, music continues to play. Out of nowhere comes Florent and stands next to her. Vivian looks at him. They converse as if they had known each other for a while, gazing eyes to eyes and smiling. However, we don't hear what they say due to the music on the soundtrack. She asks him about the painting. He explains to her. EXT Paris Street, night. Florent and Vivian take a walk, conversing.
Vivian, growing up in Canada. I wanted to be an actress, did a couple of dramas in school, but never really took it seriously. I just focused on modeling while taking classes at the University of Cambridge in England. I got my degree in astronomy. Later, I met John in a charity event. We dated for 2 years. He proposed to me. We got engaged. And I ran away. That's basically the story of my life.
Florent, humorously it sounds like a fairy tale.
Vivian, my life is a fairy tale. I can't complain. But there is something missing. I don't know what it's. Maybe, I just caught up with this royalty thing. It didn't give me a chance to do what I want to do.
Don't get me wrong. It was fun for a while. I love John more than life itself. But I have no freedom. Thought I would get used to it, you know, the paparazzi, newspapers, media, and all the tabloids take toll on you.
Florent, under his breath, I hear you.
Vivian, they want to keep me in a cage like an exotic bird that doesn't know the difference between inner peace, independent, and freedom. But my heart wants to fly wild like a falcon whose soul is caught on fire. I begin to question, is this my life? Is this what I want to do? Wake up in the morning, pose for hundreds of paparazzi, go to charities, and act like Snow White.
Florent, humorously you're about to be a princess. You'll have to find ways to deal with the pressure.
Vivian, I don't see myself as a princess. I have a life. I have a dream. I have passion. That's why I ran away and came to Paris, to collect my thoughts, maybe think it over.
Florent, they don't miss you.
Vivian, I called John last night and told him I was fine. I didn't want him to worry. I just need some breathing space from the paparazzi and all the royalty unwanted attention, odds and ends.
Florent, so, you thought the paparazzi wouldn't find you here in Paris?
Vivian, I've always loved Paris. I feel a sense of peace when I'm in Paris, regardless of anything.
Florent, I think Paris is the most romantic city in the world. We all find peace in Paris no matter what, except once in a while a beautiful girl like you comes to the city of love and makes our hearts ache more than we can bear it.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
Vivian, what about you, how long have you been painting?
Florent, since I was a baby. My parent gave me a painting brush before spoon.
Vivian, you're the most gifted artist I've ever met.
Florent, playing along, thanks.
You're the most gorgeous girl I've ever met.
They stop at a beautiful villa.
Vivian, where are we going?
We passed my hotel long time ago.
Florent, I live here. I make the best tea in Paris.
Why don't you come inside and make yourself comfortable?
Vivian, what do you mean by make myself comfortable?
Florent, nothing. Just have a cup of tea and tell me if it's better than English tea.
Vivian, English teas are the best.
I don't have to make myself comfortable to tell you that, unless you have something in your mind.
Florent, I do have something in my mind.
Vivian, what's it?
Florent, I can't tell you here.
We have to go inside.
Vivian, if you say so.
Florent opens the main gate.
Florent and Vivian enter.
EXT Florent's villa, night.
Florent and Vivian walk toward the house, crossing a breathtaking garden. We see a water fountain, a pond, statues of angels, saints, and cherubs.
Vivian is taken by the embellishment, but acts like she has seen it all, including Buckingham Palace and Kew Gardens. Perhaps nothing is new to her.
Florent and Vivian come up to the main house.
Florent opens the door. They enter in ease.
Hint.
Florent's villa, studio, night. It's an enormous studio, as big as a football stadium.
Florent and Vivian walk in.
Vivian looks at Florent's paintings. She couldn't believe how talented Florent is. We see all kinds of spiritual, mystical, and artistic paintings throughout the studio: Christ on the cross, Mary Magdalene and Christ, cherubs and Mary Mother of God, saints and angels, seraphs slaying demons, portraits of nude beautiful girls, etc. They look like photographs.
Vivian is spellbound.
Vivian, did you paint all these?
Florent nods yes.
She looks at more paintings.
Vivian, I have never seen anything like this in my life.
You're extremely talented.
Florent, have a seat.
Let me make you a tea.
Vivian sits in the main sofa.
Florent walks up to his private bar, grabs two wine glasses and a bottle of red wine, and returns to Vivian.
Vivian, that's not tea.
Florent, I know, but what is the odd of me making a tea that's better than English?
That's why France invented wine, to avoid another 100 years of war with England.
Vivian, French didn't invent wine. Archaeological evidence suggests that the earliest known production of wine, made by fermenting grapes, took place 8,000 years ago in Georgia.
Florent, humorously I didn't know that. Still someday you'll be a queen, rule England, and make important decisions.
Vivian, humorously, I don't think I'm capable of making decisions that have to do with war. I'll just watch Paris burning to the ground on BBC, unless Monet steals me from my beloved prince and convert me to Parisian with French kiss. I'll then wear an armor like Joan of the Arc and fight for France, till they burn me on a stake.
You know, since I'm from Quebec, I'm more French than British.
Florent pours the wine into the wine glasses and gives Vivian a glass of wine.
She takes the wine.
Florent sits in a sofa.
Vivian, cheers.
Florent, cheers. They connect their glasses and take sips.
Vivian couldn't take her eyes off the paintings.
Vivian, they're stimulating.
Florent says nothing.
Vivian, where do you get your inspiration?
Florent, everywhere, church, Bible.
Paris, where there is a beauty, there is inspiration.
Vivian continues to look at the paintings in wonder.
Vivian, you have very interesting nude paintings.
Are they digitalized with computer software?
Florent, under his breath, modestly, no, I painted them.
She looks more paintings.
Vivian, don't tell me all these girls pose as nude for you, did you sleep with them?
Florent smiles softly, but says nothing.
She looks at a provocative artistic painting of a seraph carrying a beautiful girl.
They're kissing, 40 inches tall and 24 inches wide.
It looks real.
Vivian is awestruck.
Vivian, how long did it take you to do that?
Florent, 3 months.
Vivian, it's beautiful.
Florent, under his breath, thanks.
Vivian, what about how long it takes to do a portrait?
Florent, it depends on the painting.
It usually takes me 3 days to a week.
But it took Leonardo da Vinci to paint Mona Lisa 16 years.
He begins in 1503 and completed it in 1519.
However, he did a couple of famous paintings in between, including Leda and the Swan.
Vivian, that is something.
But I think I'm a little bit drunk.
Puts her wine on a table, do you mind if I take my clothes off?
She gets up, removes her clothes, drops her underwear, and sits in the sofa nude, posing.
Vivian, you can do my portrait if you want to.
Florent gets behind his canvas and begins to paint her.
Close up, Florent.
Florent draws her eyes.
He draws her lips.
He draws her face.
Florent looks magician with the drawing pen.
On the soundtrack, music plays.
Close up, Vivian.
Vivian continues to pose nude for Florent as if she were in a fantasy world.
We stay with them for a bit.
Int. Florent's villa, kitchen, night.
Florent and Vivian, who is only wearing underwear, make pancakes conversing.
On the soundtrack, music continues to play.
We don't hear what they are saying due to the music.
Int. Florent's villa, studio, night.
Florent and Vivian sit at a table, enjoying pancakes while conversing.
Florent opens a wine and pours the wine in two separate wine glasses.
He gives Vivian a glass.
They cheer and take sips.
The music on the soundtrack falls in the background and plays softly.
Vivian, tell me about yourself beside painting.
Florent, what do you want to know?
Vivian, I want to know everything, imitating James Lipton, what's your favorite word?
What turns you on creatively, spiritually, or emotionally?
What sound do you love?
What's your favorite curse word?
What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
If heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Florent, ask me one at a time.
Vivian, what's your favorite word?
Florent, passion.
Vivian, what turns you on creatively, spiritually, or emotionally?
Florent, a beautiful girl like you.
Vivian, what sound do you love?
Florent, guitar.
Vivian, what's your favorite curse word?
Florent, maybe, fuck.
Vivian, what profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
Florent, poetry.
Vivian, if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Florent, you have no sin.
But you have loved a woman with all your heart and soul.
Vivian removes her underwear, places it on the table, gets up, walks up to Florent, and stands in front of him.
Florent kisses her belly.
He goes down and gives her a soft kiss on the vagina.
He gets up and kisses her breasts.
He caresses her neck.
Vivian cannot take it anymore.
She is melting with each kiss.
She cuddles him.
They kiss passionately.
Florent then picks her up and takes her to the bedroom.
Int.
Florent's villa, bedroom, night.
Florent and Vivian make love surrounded by candles.
It is steamy, seductive, and passionate.
Int.
Florent's villa, studio, day/night.
Vivian poses nude on the sofa, covering her private part with a red rose.
Florent continues to paint her on the canvas.
Note, we are doing smash takes, going back and forth, between the painting and the love scene with artistic takes.
Int.
Florent's villa, studio, day/night.
Florent and Vivian make love on a mattress that is placed in the middle of the studio surrounded by candles.
Vivian is on the top reading him, cowgirl style.
Florent gets her in the bottom and makes beautiful love to her, kissing her lips sweetly and caressing her neck, etc.
Int.
Florent's villa, studio, day/night.
Close up, Vivian.
She continues to pose nude, covering her vagina with a red rose.
Florent continues to paint her.
Int.
Florent's apartment, bedroom,
Day/night. Florent and Vivian continue to make love surrounded by candles. He is entering her enchantingly as they go at it with various sexual positions. It is steamy, enthralling, and passionate. EXT Florent's villa, garden and bathtub, night. Sparkling stars. Bright moon. Warm weather. Vivian and Florent sit in a bathtub that is placed in the middle of the garden. Florent is behind. Vivian is resting on Florent's chest. He is reciting Longing by Matthew Arnold from memory while planting soft kisses on her shoulder. Florent, softly down by her neck, come to me in my dreams, and then. By day I shall be well again. For so the night will more than pay. The hopeless longing of the day. Come, as thou camest 1,000 times. A messenger from radiant climes. And smile on thy new world, and be. As kind to others as to me. Or, as thou never camest in sooth. Come now, and let me dream it truth. And part my hair, and kiss my brow. And say, my love, why sufferest thou? Come to me in my dreams, and then. By day I shall be well again. For so the night will more than pay. The hopeless longing of the day. He kisses her on the shoulder. There is a silent moment. Vivian looks at the stars in the sky. She then. Vivian, let me ask you a question, if you have to live your life again as animal, plant, or a historical figure, or anything, what would it be? Florent, I would be love in a mist. I mean, you are my love in a mist. Instead, I would be Cupid in the springtime, Dianthus, hibiscus, and baby's breath, and make love to you till you scratch me like a cat that is under experiment of meth. I wouldn't stop even the devil asks me, how much is my soul worth? And the angels question, how is she going to give birth? I would continue to make love to you, as if love were destined nothing but mirth, till all flowers in the garden of eroticism, and every star in the skies fall on earth. You may die seemingly with pure pleasure and intense orgasm after you apparently run out of breath. Gods and goddesses couldn't believe what they are seeing, would turn creation back at the Genesis, and give Adam and Eve a daughter named Vivian that is barely alive, also known as Beth. They would forget about Cain, slayed Abel, and Seth, and say it's in place of all beautiful women, princesses, and queens as if she were slaughtered by King Macbeth. Yet, I would kiss your sweet lips, restore your heartbeat, and make you feel loved above everything else as if you rose from death. He kisses on the shoulder. Vivian, what about in the summer? Florent, in the summer, I would turn into a Bethlehem star, an orchid in the garden of redolence and dalliance, a pearl necklace, and a perfume that you carried in your purse. And make your day's belly poke, as if time were played in reverse. And your night's Mardi Gras considered sacred, and every once in a while, Dia de Muertos celebrated as the birth of life rather than demise, and far from curse. But we would pretend it's Halloween, I would act like a doctor but a villain as you play a nurse. We would do kiss scenes without a rehearse as if the definition of bad were good, free from adverse. We do few tricks with our tongues to keep it sweet and terse, as love comes to conclusion the comparative form of bad in grammar should definitely be better rather than worse. I would then make love to you till the earth quivers beneath us and rises all the dead without requiem or a hearse. Later, we would sit in a bathtub outside as if love were saying it's here to stay. I would glorify your beauty with love poems that I compose with lotus, magnolia, tulips, roses, and water lilies in April and May. How I can't wait to see your beautiful face in a summer ray, kiss your cheeks, caresses your neck, run my lips on your breasts, belly, and inner thighs as if I were celebrating your birthday. How I would wiggle my tongue between your legs, and excite your clitoris till your heart flies away like a blue jay, as if love refused to be kept in bay, and make love to you and give you first-rate sexual apex that you would not stop thinking about night and day, to prove you that I love you more than the beat of my heart and respects that I can't help but pay, which nothing can measure the depth of my soul that is sensitive to the slightest touch of beauty, and anything that is risque, as if love cut my heart and put it on a scale to weigh. Sex you with various erotic positions till I take your breath away. And when you think darkness is going to prey on your heart and extinguish the candle in your soul like a doomsday, I would kiss your lips and bring light to your way. I would then plant soft kisses on your shoulders and neck as we take bath like two teardrops that are turned into swans by Circe, and recite you love poems, which each sonnet has a seductive verse. I would kiss your lips till my heart and soul couldn't help but fall deeply in love, and give into passion that would like to immerse, and remind thee that you are the most dazzling girl in the universe. She smiles in beauty. He kisses her on the shoulder. Vivian, what about in the fall? Florent, in the fall, I would come as sea breeze, dahlia, and sunflower, endearment, osculation, and French kiss are to fall deeply in love with you every second, minute, an hour. I would gust on your lips with rose aroma and autumn mist. And cover your heart with haze and dew droplets as if I were making love to you in the shower. And quench my thirst with the wine on aphrodisiac lips, as I satisfy your heart and soul till you feel the power, of which love acquired from all hearts and each flower, and lovers that kiss French under Eiffel Tower. However, I would leave the most part of autumn to mystery, and continue to fall in love with you regardless of what the beat of your hearts think of me. He kisses her on the shoulder. Vivian, what about in the winter? Florent, in the winter, I would be snowflakes, and fall on your hair, cheeks, lips, and nose. I would whisper to you how I used to be a Renaissance painter in the previous life before they watered gardens with a hose. Once upon time, heaven was covered with ice without meadows. Time pretended to stop while ticking like a cheetah's heart, of which the feline thought his feet was on flame, and ran as fast as it could to protect its toes. But time said deceivingly for unknown reason it just froze. It wouldn't tick until further notice, and when it does, it would tell me everything what it knows,
but flied as if it had some place to go and do shows. I would tell you how I used to recite love poem to you in the morning, saying, "Sleeping Beauty, open your eyes for me. Let me come to your world, beyond the blue sea. The beat of my heart, love like thee I kiss a butterfly. To drop in your belly and flap my wings tenderly, as if I were dancing with your heart that had gone crazy. And couldn't help but drop in your tummy without the aid of the magnetic force of your cervix and space-time curvature to combat pains and aches that stand against liberty, while thinking it would finally be free, and your soul, which happened to be floating in zero gravity. Allow me to remove your underwear if you are wearing any. And do things you thought modestly it would never happen to you, but wish they poured down on your soul, tantalizing sensation, uncontrollable orgasms, luscious passion, enchanting climax that give a new twist to your confidence, eroticism, and sensuality. And sweet kisses that you assumed they were nothing but starch and fairy tales written by a man who was stung by a honeybee, and make love to you till thy spirit jumps out of your body. Still the sun refused to shine and hid behind shadows. The moon faked chest pain and turned to red, as if it were hit with elbows. The stars said they got sick, and began to fall from the sky like storm that consists of ices and snows, in the reminiscence of wild precipitation without consulting the weather, as if they were going through a great deal of throes. I would breeze on your lips, and tell you how I broke the spell with a kiss, and then how angels and seraphs started fighting flirtingly with primroses and snows, and enemies and friends with pillows that didn't have logos, and saints couldn't help but indulge themselves with grapes, cherries, strawberries, peaches, and bicerin, gingiato and cafe mocha to keep them hallucinated rather than warm, and gingija which they made from cocos. I would tell you how I dreamed about kissing you in a twilight, and giving you a rose that I plant in Mars, how I kiss your lips French while decorating your heart with light that I stole from the stars. And how my heart grew wings and produced energy that hurled defiance at the horsepower of thousands of cars. How it left my body, flied across the cosmos, and wrote some of the most beautiful poems, essays, and memoirs. Yet, I remember how I didn't want to part my lips from your lips, as if my soul were chained with fire and locked behind invisible bars. In other words, I would kiss your addictive lips four seasons, and admit tenderly how my heart became a petal that fell from a rose, which your lips are the source of all saccharinity and sucrose, to bring me more joy, ache, and sweet love to my soul from January to December better than anything out there, including songs that heavens and the garden of melody compose, as if not only did love touch an organ that it chose, but also affects a metaphysical entity that lives on sucrose. I would then turn into dream and melt in your heart, anytime you take your clothes off, and does a pose. Later, after I do your portrait inside your heart, I would turn into fever, steam out, kiss your lips, and make love to you until your soul glows. Vivian smiles in beauty. Florent and Vivian kiss French. Note, the poem will be kept short during filming. Int. Florent's villa, bedroom, morning. Vivian and Florent make more love. It's steamy, risque, and passionate. We stay with them in series cuts. Montage, London. London, a quick take of the City of London, Tower Bridge and London Eye, City of London, Palace of Westminster, Buckingham Palace, Kew Gardens, Westminster Abbey, St. Margaret's Church, Piccadilly Circus, St. Paul's Cathedral, Tower Bridge and Trafalgar Square and many more. EXT London Cafe, day. Jake and Luke sit at a table in the pub, drinking coffees and smoking cigarette. Jake is working on his laptop, looking at the photos of Vivian. An attractive young woman walked by, on the sidewalk. Jake looks at her butt. Jake, look that ass. A girl gone butt wild. A perfect 13. I'll hit that fatty acids till kingdom comes. Luke, man, we're not here in this world to fuck like dogs. We have responsibilities. I'm not planning to spend the rest of my life chasing pussies. Jake, what are you talking about? Luke, we have to live our lives accordingly. Life is worth much more than chasing asses. Jake phone rings. Jake, on the phone, what's up, Dwayne? EXT London Eye / London Cafe, day. Dwayne, 34, walks in the park at London Eye while talking to Jake on his cell phone. Note, we see both sides of the conversation. Dwayne, on the phone, guess what The Rock is cooking? Jake, what's The Rock cooking? Dwayne, Vivian is in Paris. Jake, what do you mean she is Paris? Dwayne, this guy just sold me a photo of Vivian taken in Paris few days ago. Jake, you're kidding. Dwayne, no. I'm not kidding. He said he got the photo from his sister. The fool lost all his money, bet the photo and handed it over to me. You can have it for £550. Jake, where in Paris is she staying? Dwayne, I have no fucking clue. She could be staying on top of the Eiffel Tower for all I know. Jake, never mind. Thanks. I'll find her. Dwayne, what about the photo? You don't want it? Jake, I'll give you £100. Dwayne, why do you always step on my balls, Jake? I got the picture for £350. Jake, that's too bad. That photo is probably in Instagram as we speak. The reason I'm offering you 100 is, cause you told me she's in Paris, the kindness of my heart. Dwayne, okay, you can have it for 200. Jake, 100 is my final offer. Take it or leave it. Dwayne, okay. 100 is fine. I'll send it via to your cell phone. Dwayne sends the photo via to Jake's cell phone. Jake looks at the photo of Vivian taken at Les Deux Magots Cafe. Jake, to himself, Les Deux Magots, on the phone, thanks. I'll cancel £300 that you owed me for the Red Devils.
Dwayne, come on, Jake. You can't be cheap like that. You said that you were happy man you beat Chelsea. You didn't give a fuck about the bet.
Jake, I was kind of drunk.
Dwayne, fuck you. You and the Red Devils are going to burn in hell, bastard.
Jake, I just let you slide with £200. The least you can say is thank you, bell end.
Dwayne, arsehole. You are going to sell that bloody bitch for £500,000, and I get nothing.
Jake, it's not your fault. It's the world that we are living in, pillock.
Bye. Jake hangs up. We stay with Jake. Jake takes a sip from his coffee and turns his attention back to Vivian.
Jake, to Luke, Vivian is in Paris. We're back in business.
Int. Florence Villa, Studio, Day. Vivian poses nude lying on an exotic bed placed for the sole purpose of the painting. Florent does her portrait. It is a new portrait. Vivian is in the middle of telling him a story.
Vivian, Isolde was supposed to marry Tristan's uncle King Mark of Cornwall. Tristan was escorting her to his uncle. They ingested a love potion and fell madly in love on their way to Cornwall. Isolde ended up marrying King Mark, but the love potion made it impossible for Tristan and Isolde to resist each other. They began to have affair behind the king. They got caught by Isolde's husband. The king sentenced them to death. Tristan managed to escape. He rescued Isolde. They ran to the forest. But Isolde was forced to return to Mark. Tristan was asked to leave Cornwall. He married another woman named Isolde. Later, he was wounded by a poison lance while attempting to rescue a young woman from six knights. Tristan sent his friend Keaton to find Isolde, the only person who could heal him. Tristan told Keaton to sail back with white sails if he was bringing Isolde, and black sails if he is not. Isolde agreed to return to Tristan with Keaton, but Tristan's jealous wife lied to Tristan about the color of the sails. Tristan died of grief, thinking that Isolde didn't love him. Isolde died of grief too after she found Tristan dead.
Florent, what about the story of Lancelot and Guinevere?
They're similar to Tristan and Isolde.
Vivian, they're similar.
Guinevere was married to King Arthur. Guinevere and Lancelot fell in love after he rescued her from the evil Meleagant. Later, the king found out Guinevere was having an affair with his most loyal knight Lancelot, which led to the distraction of the Knights of the Round Table. Guinevere was eventually condemned to be burned at the stake for adultery. Lancelot, who escaped prosecution, rescued her after killing a lot of King Arthur's knight. Arthur waged war against Lancelot. Before going away for battle, Arthur left Mordred, his nephew, temporarily in charge of Camelot. But Mordred wanted the kingdom for himself and challenged Arthur in a sword fight. Arthur killed Mordred. However, the king was mortally wounded in the duel. Later, he died. Guinevere, who was saddened by Arthur's death, entered a convent. Lancelot entered hermit and became a priest. Both spent the rest of their lives in repentance.
Florent, that is a very interesting story. But is it true that King Arthur is still alive?
Vivian, there is a mythical version. Arthur didn't die. Instead, after the sword fight, he was taken to the magical island of Avalon. He recovered from his wounds, and still waits to return to England in the future when they need him the most. He's considered to be the future king.
Florent, humorously you're about to marry the future king of England.
I should enter hermit, become a priest, and spend the rest of my life in repentance.
Vivian, I would love to follow your footsteps and enter a convent too. But I'm not very good at being a nun.
I would probably seduce you. You'd forget that you have entered hermit. I would end up having sex with you without guilt, and make love to you till the day I die.
Florent, it's hard to resist that. I think I'll just die in your arm after we make love so many times.
She smiles in beauty.
Vivian, anyway, I feel like I'm dreaming.
Florent, you'd better wake up, princess. Life is a beautiful morning. The sun doesn't shine without you.
Vivian, I hope you don't mind if I dream little dreams of love, till I get a kiss from my beloved Florent.
Florent, as you wish, buttercup.
Florent puts his painting brush aside, walks up to her, and gives her a soft kiss on the lips.
She drops the rose, throws her arms around him. They kiss more passionately. He then caresses her necks, kisses her collarbone.
Vivian is melting inside faster than an ice in a boiling whiskey.
Florent slowly goes down, kissing her breasts and caressing her belly. He opens her legs, kisses her inner thigh, and begins to give her oral pleasure.
Close up, Vivian.
She sighs deeper, breathing in and out. She is going through all kinds of sexual pleasure phases. On the soundtrack, French song plays.
Int.
Florence Villa, Studio, minutes later. Vivian and Florent make love. We see Vivian in beautiful passion as Florent enters her. It's a passionate sex. We stay with them for a bit.
Int.
Vivian's convertible Bentley, moving, Day. Vivian is behind the wheel, driving in the street of Paris.
EXT Vivian's convertible Bentley, moving, Day.
A medium shot of Vivian's convertible Bentley as she drives in the street of Paris. A SUV is following Vivian's convertible Bentley.
Int.
SUV, moving, Day. Luke is behind the wheel. Jake is in the passenger seat. He has his camera out, photographing Vivian.
Int.
Vivian's convertible Bentley, moving, Day. Vivian looks at the rear mirror, and sees the SUV following her. Vivian steps on the gas and drives faster. Int. SUV, moving, day. Jake and Luke speed up as well, following Vivian's convertible Bentley. EXT Vivian's convertible Bentley and SUV, moving, day.
Various shots of Vivian's convertible Bentley driving in the street of Paris. And Jake's and Luke following the Bentley.
Then. Vivian's convertible Bentley runs a stop sign.
A car, an Audi, hits Vivian's convertible Bentley.
Vivian's convertible Bentley spins on the road.
Int.
Vivian's convertible Bentley, day.
Vivian hits her head against the wheel.
Her car begins to smoke.
Vivian's POV, everything looks cloudy.
The screen is blurry.
Vivian's eyes are slowly closed in ease.
EXT slash int.
Vivian's convertible Bentley, later.
We see ambulances, French police officers, and firefighters moving in chaos.
Vivian is unconscious.
Two paramedics place oxygen mask on her mouth.
They slowly carry her out of the car and put her on a medical stretcher.
Jake and Luke stand among the crowd.
Jake continues to take photographs.
The paramedics come to the ambulance and place Vivian in the medical vehicle.
The paramedics get in their ambulance, start the car, and drive away, blaring sirens and flashing emergency lights.
Montage, news.
BBC News, we see a photo of Vivian on the side of the screen.
A female reporter Anita reports the story from BBC headquarters.
Anita, Vivian Parker, who is recently engaged to Prince John the Duke of Buckingham, was involved in a car accident.
CNN News, we see a video of Vivian walking on a catwalk.
A male reporter Richard Cooper addresses the news from CNN headquarters.
Richard, Vivian Parker got in a major car accident.
Fox News, a female reporter Grace addresses the news from ABC headquarters.
Grace, Vivian Parker was involved in a car crashed.
ABC News, a male reporter Terry addresses the news from St. Germain Hospital.
Terry, Vivian Parker, Prince John's fiance, was involved in a car crashed earlier this morning.
She was taken here at St. Germain Hospital in Paris.
The doctor said she's in coma.
EXT St. Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day.
Vivian sleeps in coma.
At the entrance, Prince John, Vivian father Robert Parker, 54, Vivian's mother, as beautiful as Vivian, Natalie Parker, 48, her grandmother, a delightful woman who aged gracefully, Amy Peary, 69, Vivian's sister, who looks like she just came out of sliver screen, Jennifer Parker, 22, and her younger brother Brian Parker, 14, walk in.
At first, Prince John and Vivian's family seem panic.
They all stand around her.
But there is absolute beauty, serenity, and grace on Vivian's face as if she were possessed by a supernatural force beyond our understanding.
They are speechless.
Her grandmother breaks the silence.
Amy, she looks like an angel.
Natalie's eyes fill with tears.
Natalie, I'm sorry, Vivian.
I love you.
Please, come to me.
I will never let anything happen to you as long as I live.
Natalie kisses Vivian on the forehead.
She then dries her tears with her hand.
Close up, Vivian.
She looks like Sleeping Beauty.
The camera travels through her eyes dexterously, and comes to Florent's studio.
Int.
Florent's villa, studio, day.
Medium shot of Vivian's nude portrait.
Vivian comes out of the canvas miraculously, nude.
She looks around, and walks toward the living room.
Int.
Florent's villa, living room, day.
Vivian comes up to the living room naked.
She sees Florent's clean laundry in a basket near the sofa.
Vivian grabs Florent's t-shirt and a soccer short and puts them on.
Vivian then walks into the kitchen.
Florent's villa, kitchen.
Vivian opens the refrigerator, grabs a slice of cake left on a plate, and closes the refrigerator.
Vivian takes the cake with her hand and has a bite.
In the meantime, she sees Florent's sketchbook on the table.
Vivian puts the cake on the counter, licks her fingers, grabs the sketchbook and flips the pages, looking at the sketches of nude young Parisian women.
Vivian then walks toward the living room while looking at the sketches.
Yet, she steps on something, slips, and falls on the floor.
Close up, Vivian.
She lies unconscious on the kitchen floor.
Int. Paris bar, night.
Florent sits at a table, drinking scotch, double.
He is sad.
On the stage, a young woman named Laura sings a sad French song.
Florent listens to the song.
He then drinks everything in one breath, gets up and leaves.
EXT Paris Street, night.
Florent walks in the street of Paris.
On the soundtrack, Laura continues to sing in French.
EXT Florent's villa, night.
An established shot of Florent's villa.
Florent comes up to his villa, opens the gate, and enters without thinking about the existence of life as if he were lost in his heart to the point of no return.
EXT Florent's villa, garden, night.
Florent walks down the garden, comes up to the house, opens the door, and enters in ease.
Int.
Florent's villa, living room and kitchen, night.
Vivian remains on floor lying unconscious.
Florent come up to the main living room, walks toward the kitchen, and sees Vivian.
Kitchen.
Florent walks up to Vivian, and looks at her face.
It's her.
His heart skips a million beats in a blink of an eye figuratively speaking, but it beats faster.
He doesn't know how she got there.
Florent slowly carries her and exits the kitchen.
Living room.
Florent walks down the living room, carrying Vivian, climbs the staircases, and takes her to the bedroom.
Florent's bedroom.
Florent slowly places Vivian on his bed.
Florent looks at her eyes.
He doesn't know what is going on.
Vivian opens her eyes and looks at him. Vivian, under her breath, Florent.
Florent, hi.
Vivian, I'm thirsty.
Florent, I'll get you a glass of water.
Florent turns around, and exits the bedroom. Corridor, staircases, and living room. Florent passes the corridor, runs down the staircases, walks down the living room, and enters the kitchen.
Kitchen.
Florent grabs a glass, fills it with tap water, and heads back to the bedroom.
Int.
Florent's villa, bedroom, night. Vivian has gone back to sleep. Florent enters with the glass of water and looks at her in wonder. Florent doesn't want to wake her up, puts the water on the mirror table, and continues to look at her with tenderness, as if she were the most beautiful soul ever, created out of his heart. On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously. Florent slowly exits from the bedroom. We stay with Vivian for a bit.
Int.
Florent's villa, studio, night. Florent comes up to his studio and looks at the portrait of Vivian. She is not there. He thinks, did she come out of the portrait?
It can't be.
How did this happen? There must be some kind of explanation.
Int.
Florent's villa, bedroom, night. Vivian remains asleep. Florent returns with a sketching board, sits on the sofa, and begins to draw her. We stay with them for a bit.
Int.
Florent's villa, kitchen, day. Florent cooks breakfast, pancakes, scrambled eggs and French toast. On a stereo, French song is playing.
Int.
Florent's villa, bedroom, day. Vivian opens her eyes. There is a red bloom rose next to her. She grabs the rose, smells it and smiles in beauty. Vivian gets up from the bed and walks toward the living room.
Int.
Florent's villa, living room, day. Vivian sees her sketch, Sleeping in Beauty, on the coffee table. She's speechless how amazingly gifted Florent really is. It looks like a black and white photograph. Living room slash kitchen, day. Florent continues to make the breakfast. Vivian appears at the entrance, holding the rose. Florent sees her.
Florent, in French, good morning.
Vivian, in French, good morning. There is a silent moment.
He then.
Florent, breakfast is in its way.
Have a seat.
Breakfast room. Vivian turns around, walks up to a breakfast table, puts down the rose on the table, pulls a chair, and sits.
Kitchen.
Florent places pancakes, scrambled eggs, and French toast on a plate. He opens the refrigerator, takes out orange juice and pours the juice in a glass. Florent places the meal and the juice on a tray and come to the breakfast room.
Breakfast room.
Florent places the meal in front of Vivian.
Vivian, I have headache.
Do you have aspirin?
Florent, let me see.
Florent walks toward the bathroom. Vivian grabs a French toast, has a small bit, mooches, and downs it with orange juice. She waits for Florent while listening to the music.
Int.
Florent's villa, bathroom, day. Florent grabs Advil from the mirror box, closes the mirror box, and returns to the living room.
Breakfast room.
Vivian takes another sip from her orange juice. Florent comes to Vivian with the medicine.
Florent, I only got Advil.
Vivian, that's fine. He opens the top, and gives her the medicine.
Florent, do you want a glass of water?
Vivian, it's okay. I'll take it with orange juice. Florent sits at the table. Vivian places the pills in her mouth and downs them with the juice. Florent looks at her eyes with wonder.
He then.
Florent, how did you get here?
Vivian, I don't remember.
She continues to eat. There is a silent moment.
She then.
Vivian, where is your breakfast? Florent needs time to collect his thoughts. He is not thinking about eating. Perhaps he is not going to eat for a while till he figured out what is going on. However, he comes up with a good excuse.
Florent, I'm fasting.
Vivian, what do you mean you're fasting? Are you Muslim?
Florent, no.
I'm not Muslim. It's just. I'm trying to master the art of self-discipline, and gather spiritual energy.
Vivian, what spiritual energy?
Florent, I'm told when you fast, spirits that are beyond this world guide you into phenomena.
Vivian, I'll try it some other time, and see what these phenomena that you are talking about look like.
But today, I'm hungry. My stomach is burning like hell. Florent smiles softly. In the meantime, Vivian realizes she is wearing Florent's clothes.
Vivian, I hope you don't mind I'm wearing your clothes.
Florent, you look sexy. You can keep them.
Vivian, thanks.
But I was thinking about buying new dresses. I didn't bring any cloth. She gives him a wink.
Florent continues to look at her as if she were the most fascinating thing that he had ever seen in his life.
Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian sleeps in coma. Dr. Laurent Remy and Prince John are in the room. Dr. Remy holds up Vivian's MRI and shows the MRI result to Prince John.
Dr. Remy, no serious injury. No fracture, or anything that's out of ordinary. She should come out of it in a day too.
John, what kind of coma state or scale did you say that she is in?
Dr. Remy, 14 GCS.
John, what's that?
Dr. Remy, GCS, the Glasgow Coma Scale, is a neurological scale that intends to give a certain way of recording the conscious state of a patient in scale of 3 to 15.
3 indicates deep unconsciousness and 15 light unconsciousness. She is in 14. John looks at her eyes. John, can she hear me if I talk to her in the scale of 14?
Dr. Remy, there are testimonies that patients, who were in deep state of coma, heard their loved ones talking to them.
John, so that means she can hear me.
Dr. Remy, I believe so.
John, what do you mean you believe so?
I want a straight answer.
Yes. She can hear me.
No. She can't hear me.
Dr. Remy doesn't want to argue with him. He just tells him what he wants to hear.
Dr. Remy, yes, she can hear you.
John takes a deep breath and look at Vivian's eyes.
John, I don't know where to start.
Vivian. The doctor said you can hear me. I hope you do the sake of my soul, because I love you more than the cells in my heart. All I want in life is you to be happy. I promise we'll get married as soon as you come out of it. I would never let you out of my sight again. He kisses her on the forehead.
Int. Paris Boutique, day.
Vivian comes out of the dressing room, wearing a white Stella McCartney gown, and shows Florent the dress. Florent tells her that she looks like an angel.
Cut to.
Vivian comes out of the dressing room, wearing a gold Emilio Pucci dress, and shows Florent the dress.
Cut to.
Vivian comes out of the dressing room, wearing a black Christian Dior gown, and shows Florent the dress.
Cut to.
Vivian comes out of the dressing room in a Betsy Johnson dress and shows Florent the dress.
Cut to.
Vivian comes out of the dress room, wearing a purple Dolce & Gabbana gown.
Cut to.
Vivian comes out of the dressing room, wearing a red John Galliano gown, and shows the dress to Florent. Florent tells her she looks irresistible. She walks up to him, and puts her arms around his neck. They kiss French. EXT Café, day. Florent and Vivian, who is wearing a black Yves Saint Laurent gown, sit in a pub with glasses of red wine. We see all kinds of shopping bags near Vivian.
Vivian, I'm going to stay with you for a while.
Florent, sure. There is a silent moment.
Florent, how did you really get here?
Vivian, I told you I don't remember.
Florent, it has to be an explanation.
Vivian, what's the explanation? He thinks for 3 seconds.
Florent, it can't be.
Vivian, what do you mean by it can't be?
Florent, did you come out of the portrait?
Vivian, I don't remember. There is another silent moment.
Florent can't take his eyes off her.
Florent, I think we have to go to the hospital and visit her.
Vivian, visit who?
Florent, Vivian.
Vivian, I'm Vivian.
Florent, if you're Vivian, so tell me what's your favorite word? What turns you on creatively, spiritually, or emotionally? What sound do you love? What's your favorite curse word? What profession other than your own would you like to attempt? If heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Vivian, ask me one at a time.
Florent, what's your favorite word?
Vivian, romance.
Florent, what turns you on creatively, spiritually, or emotionally?
Vivian, a handsome man like you.
Florent, what sound do you love?
Vivian, piano.
Florent, what's your favorite curse word?
Vivian, fuck me.
Florent can't help but smile.
Florent, what profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
Vivian, painting.
Florent, if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Vivian, you have no sin. But you have loved a man with all your heart and soul.
Florent smiles in wonder.
On the soundtrack, music plays. EXT Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day. It's a 2014 Mercedes-Benz S-Class convertible. Florent is behind the wheel. Vivian is in the passenger seat. They are driving in the street of Paris.
Montage, Paris.
The Eiffel Tower, Café Les Deux Magots in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, skyscrapers of La Défense, Notre Dame de Paris, panoramic view of the Isle Saint-Louis, the Place de la Concorde, Avenue de Champs-Élysées, Seine River, Paris bridges and many more. EXT Saint-Germain Hospital, day. An established shot of Saint-Germain Hospital. EXT Saint-Germain Hospital, day. We see commotion at the entrance, media, paparazzi, polices, securities and a couple of fans moving in chaos. Journalist can't wait to hear the latest on the status of Vivian. They are asking the doctors all kinds of questions.
John is outside.
John is answering few questions, saying she is going to be fine and all. Camera lights are flashing from everywhere. A couple of secret services keep eyes on John.
Meanwhile, Natalie's parents, Vivian and Robert, step out of the hospital.
Medias and paparazzi ambush them, flashing their camera lights. They ask them all kinds of questions, regarding to the well-being of their daughter. John's publicist exits the building on time and says that Vivian is in coma. The doctors assured him she would wake up soon. For every prayer, kind word, and thought, the family is deeply grateful with heartfelt appreciation. However, they wish their privacy to be respected at these moments of uncertainty, confusion, and sadness, but hope and optimism to the full extent of their hearts. A Mercedes SUV comes driving through the crowd, and pulls over next to Vivian's parents. The Secret Service men push the crowd aside. Natalie and Robert get in the back seat. John enters in passenger seat. The car drive away. Florent's Mercedes convertible. Florent and Vivian, who is wearing a big sunglass,
come driving and park the car near the hospital. They look at the chaos, get out of the car, and walk toward the hospital quietly.
Int.
Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian sleeps in coma. Florent and Vivian enter, dressing as doctor and nurse. Luckily, nobody is there. Florent looks at the comatose Vivian. She looks as beautiful as ever. He looks at Vivian, who comes out of the portrait. He can't tell the difference between them. They are the same persons. Florent continues to look at the sleeping Vivian. He doesn't know what to say to her. His eyes are filled with tears. They sparkle like the stars. If he blinks his eyes, tears would leave his eyes. Florent gets closer and kisses her on the lips. Vivian, who comes out of the portrait, feels the kiss. She touches her lips. It tastes like love. She can't help but smile in beauty. There is a soft smile on the comatose Vivian. Yet it disappears in a heartbeat. Florent thinks, did she just smile? He thought it could be his imagination. Florent turns and looks at Vivian, who comes out of the portrait. There is the same smile on her face. He doesn't want to ask a lot of questions. Ext Père Lachaise Cemetery, day. Florent and Vivian take a walk in the famous Père Lachaise Cemetery, looking at the lavishly designed crypts. Florent, a lot of famous people are buried here. Jim Morrison, The Doors lead singer, the French playwright Molière, Oscar Wilde, Edith Piaf, and many more. Vivian, it's weird. I'm not afraid of death. But ironically, I'm terrified of cemeteries for some unknown reason. Florent, why's that? Vivian, I don't know, maybe I don't like the idea there are people buried in coffins, their bodies decaying and all the bones and skeletons. It's not a glamorous sight. When I died, I want them to burn my body and scatter my ash on the Seine River. Actually, I want them to scatter it on the moon, or maybe Mars if they make it. If they don't, just scatter it on space. You know, if they scatter my ash on the Seine River, it'll float on the river and sink at the bottom of English Channel. Something tells me that would be more depressive than to be buried on the ground. Florent, humorously, I doubt you will die. I think you will live forever. But God forbidden, suppose you get on a spaceship and pass the blue sky. You would then step out of the rocket without a spacesuit, free fly in zero gravity, and get lost in the space. You wouldn't die. You would turn into stardust and scatter across the skies and light up the universe. Vivian, playing along, that's how I want to go out, lost in space. Or maybe lying on your chest, listening to your heartbeat. I would then kiss your lips and take my last breath. After that, I don't care, they can throw my body in Seine River without burning it. I will tell God, or the devil, I had the time of my life. Florent smiles softly. Florent, humorously, if they throw you in the Seine River, you might turn into a mermaid and live in the water. But you will never die. Vivian, joking, I don't want to be a mermaid. The sharks will eat me. You know, I like to keep it trim and neat. Florent smiles big. He knows what she means. They look at a beautiful cemetery. Florent, humorously, what about, if they built you that kind of gravestone, would you reconsider it? Vivian, it looks marvelous. But I will have to pass. There is a silent moment. They continue to walk, looking at captivating tombstones. Yet Florent senses something. Florent, I think I brought you the wrong place. Vivian, no. This is actually beautiful. It's my imagination going horror. You know, the decaying thing scares me more than hell. Florent, it's only flesh and bone that decay. Buddha talked about reincarnation, how the spirit returns in another body. The soul is imperishable. We have lived many lives without our knowledge. Vivian, I would like to think life is not measured by how many lives we have lived in the previous lives. But it's measured by the number of lives we've touched while we're alive. Florent, humorously, you have touched mine more than I could have imagined. Vivian, you are romantic. But do you think reincarnation with past lives' memories would be accommodating somehow? Florent, I don't know, our brains are incapable of saving all past lives' information in memories. Even though life is beautiful, there are memories that better left forgotten, you know, like getting eaten by wild animals in the Stone Ages, surviving the Ice Ages, slavery, First and Second World War. It's a lot of junk. Life likes to keep it simple. Vivian, playing along, what about? We could have been lovers in the previous life. Doesn't that mean anything to you? Florent, it means everything. If it were up to me, I wouldn't mind spending the rest of my eternal life in the darkest part of hell with your memories. Yet, since we don't remember anything about the past lives, we can rule out reincarnation. I think the gods will just make us angels and place us in heavens. The universe is infinite. Vivian, angels are nothing but humans who live in a parallel universe that occupies the same space and time with our universe but exists in hidden dimensions. They evolved from Homo sapiens to supreme being. They're billions light years ahead of us. Florent, humorously, who knows, they might have evolved from Neanderthal. Vivian, it's possible. But I wouldn't bet on it. I have seen the Neanderthal story in the Discovery Channel, their fossil sites and how they brought them back with computer animation. They look like demons. Florent smiles big. Florent, humorously, I think we should go to some other place. They walk toward the cemetery summit as they continue to visit more headstones. On the soundtrack, music plays. Ext Sacre Coeur, day. An established shot of Sacre Coeur at the highest point of Paris on the Montmartre knoll.
Int. Sacre Cœur,
day.
Florent and Vivian visit Sacre Cœur.
Vivian looks at the basilica's garish gold mosaic interiors.
Ext Sacre Cœur,
terrace,
day.
Florent and Vivian look at a breathtaking view of Paris.
Ext Montmartre,
day.
They take a walk, climbing Montmartre's formidable hills and stairs while exploring the winding, village-like streets of Montmartre.
On the soundtrack, music continues to play melodiously.
Ext Florent's Mercedes convertible,
moving,
day.
Florent is behind the wheel.
Vivian is in the passenger seat.
They drive in the street of Paris.
Ext Latin Quarter,
the Sorbonne University,
day.
Florent and Vivian take a walk at the Sorbonne University in Latin Quarter.
Vivian, let me ask you a question.
If somehow you travel through wormhole to a parallel universe and meet your copy, what would you have said to him?
Florent, that's an interesting question.
They stand lips to lips.
Florent, softly by her lips, I would have asked him if he has ever been in love with a girl, whom he sees his soul sparkling in her alluring eyes, his heart beating on her sweet lips as if he had never told lies.
Can he remember moments that his heartbeat cease?
She is more beautiful than all the goddesses in Rome and Greece.
Does he love her so much, and nothing gives him peace?
You're Vivian.
I don't want to know how it happened.
And I don't care whether I am dreaming, or not.
They kiss French.
On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously.
Ext Paris,
night.
An established shot of Paris in the night.
We see helicopter flying in the air.
Int.
Helicopter,
flying,
night.
Florent is flying the helicopter.
Vivian sits next to him, looking at the city of Paris in the night.
It's spectacular.
Now, we know why they call Paris City of Lights.
It feels like we are in the future.
On the soundtrack, music continues to play.
Vivian asks him a question about how to fly the helicopter.
Florent shows her.
He lets his hand go and tells her to fly it.
Vivian flies the helicopter.
Ext Paris,
helicopter,
flying,
night.
Medium shot of the helicopter flying in the air.
To our surprise, Vivian is a good plot for a beginner, despite the fact the helicopter spinning all over the place like a wild butterfly.
She still holds the air.
Int.
Helicopter,
flying,
night.
Vivian gets it under control and flies the helicopter a little bit more.
She then tells Florent to take over.
Florent takes over and flies the helicopter in ease.
Ext helicopter,
flying,
night.
Florent and Vivian fly over City of Lights as if the city belonged only to none other than them.
On the soundtrack, a French song plays melodiously.
Int.
Restaurant,
night.
It's a romantic 5-stars restaurant.
Florent and Vivian sit at a table with glasses of red wine.
They are conversing.
But we don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack.
Florent gives Vivian his hand to dance.
She takes his hand.
They get up, come to the dance floor, and dance slow.
Vivian tells him something humorous.
Florent smiles in wonder, tells her something romantic.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
They kiss French.
Int.
Florent's villa,
bedroom,
night.
Florent and Vivian make love.
It is steamy, alluring, and passionate.
Florent is between Vivian's legs, making beautiful love to her.
On the soundtrack, music plays.
Vivian then gets on top of Florent and rides him seductively.
Florent then places her on the bottom and enters her deliciously while kissing her lips and caressing her neck.
Vivian is loving it.
Each penetration is bringing her closer to heaven.
She is making all kinds of sexual sounds.
We stay with them with series cuts as they go at it with various sexual positions that make Kama Sutra PG, 13.
Int.
Saint Germain Hospital,
Vivian's room,
day.
Vivian sleeps in coma.
Amanda sits in a chair, reading Little Women by Louisa May Alcott for Vivian.
On the soundtrack, music continues to play.
There is a soft, beautiful smile on Vivian's face as if she were having a beautiful dream.
Amanda notices the smiles on Vivian's face and smiles to herself in wonder.
Ext Florent's house,
kitchen,
day.
Florent makes breakfast,
pancakes.
He turns off the stove, places the pancakes on a plate, applies syrup, cream, slices of strawberries, chopped bananas, a slice of orange, and ice cream, and takes it to the breakfast room.
Breakfast room.
Vivian sits at the breakfast table,
nude.
She is only wearing Victoria's Secret underwear.
Florent comes up to the breakfast table with the meal, places the breakfast in front of her, and sits at the table.
Vivian eats like a sweet hungry cat to replace the energy that she lost last night.
Yet she has a lot of style.
They are conversing.
However, we don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack.
Vivian feeds him a slice of strawberry with her spoon.
Florent eats it.
Vivian asks him a question.
He answers her question.
Florent must have said something romantic.
Vivian smiles in beauty,
gets up, comes up to Florent, and sits on his lap.
They talk between soft kisses.
They then kiss French.
Int.
Louvre,
day.
Florent and Vivian visit the Louvre, the Shepherds of Arcadia by Boussat, Venus de Milo, the Nike of Samothrace, Winged Victory, Romanesque architecture from France, Saint Michael and the Devil, 12th century, Saint Francis receiving the stigmata by Giotto, the Annunciation by Rogier van der Weyden, the Pieta of Villeneuve-l'Avignon by Ingrid Corton, Portrait of an Old Man and His Grandson by Ghirlandaio, the Moneylenders by Quentin Massies, Baltasar de Castiglione by Raphael, the Mona Lisa by Leonardo da Vinci,
etc. Ext Louvre, day. Florent and Vivian take a walk by the pyramid. Vivian, I looked at most of the paintings at the Louvre closely. But none of them are as good as your paintings. Yours look like photographs. Florent, I think they're amazing. They just didn't have some of the artificial inks and advanced painting equipment we have nowadays. Vivian, I doubt it. Florent, for instance, Picasso. He's an amazing artist. Vivian, Picasso was a mental disaster as if an accident were waiting to happen. His drawing make no sense whatsoever. Florent, Picasso's method of painting is abstract expressionism. They might seem confusing, but they have deep hidden meanings. It's like mathematics. Vivian, I just like your painting style. It's seductive. You don't have to be an art critic to love them, you know, you focus on human faces, emotions, figures, and spirituality. It's medieval with a modern touch, except it's hard to separate them with photographs, or computer software. They look authentic. You will be famous soon or later. Florent, humorously, I could have been more famous than Jesus Christ. Vivian, what happened? Florent, I was approached by art critics. They questioned my method of painting. You know, how I did it? Basically they want to know if they were computer Photoshop done with software. I told them I couldn't share my secret jokingly. They just assumed they were done with photograph software, and published the story in the newspapers without my knowledge. A famous French magazine gave me a chance to clarify the story, but I refused. Vivian, why is that? Florent, I don't know, maybe, I didn't want too much attention. There is this peace that comes with freedom. You can do whatever you want to do when you're free. Nobody would bother you. They continue to talk. On the soundtrack, music plays. Ext Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day. Florent and Vivian drive in the street of Paris. Florent is behind the wheel. Vivian is in the passenger seat. On the soundtrack, music continues to play. Montage, Paris. The Eiffel Tower, Café Les Deux Magots in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, skyscrapers of La Défense, Notre Dame de Paris, panoramic view of the Isle Saint-Louis, the Place de la Concorde, Avenue de Champs-Élysées, Seine River, Paris bridges and many more. Ext Seine River, Florent's boat, day. It's a big boat. Florent and Vivian come up to the boat. A young man named Moussa is in the middle of fixing the boat. On the soundtrack, the music plays softly. Florent greets Moussa, waving his hand. Moussa returns his greeting. Florent, that's Moussa. He's fixing the engine. Florent and Vivian enter the boat. We see a couple of guys remodeling the boat. Florent, I just bought the boat secondhand from an art collector that I know. I'm remodeling it. They come up to the deck. Vivian looks at the boat. Vivian, it's a big boat. It must have cost you quite a fortune. Florent, under his breath, it's a little bit expensive but worth every penny. They walk up to the front and stand next to the frame, looking at the river. Vivian, this is beautiful. Florent, I thought about sailing around the world. But I hate the idea of leaving Paris. There is a silent moment. Vivian gets closer to Florent's lips. Vivian, softly by his lips Florent. They exchange soft kisses. Florent, under his breath, what's it, sweetheart? Vivian, seductively by his lips, what do you love the most about me? Florent, your eyes are out of this world. But I can't get enough your lips. They exchange soft kisses. Vivian, why can't you get enough of them? Florent, they're the sweetest. She smiles in beauty. They exchange soft kisses. Vivian, tell me something I don't know, like if you have to live your life again as Cupid, what would you have done? Florent, I would have turned into a summer breeze, gusted on your delicious lips sweetly 2 miles per hour, and quenched my thirst with the covenant of your scrumptious lips, till your heart turns into a wildflower. And when you think, love is nothing but destiny, and doubt, haven't the wine on your lips drowned more phenomenon, passion, and saints than a crimson sea? I'll drop in your heart, plant a red rose in your soul, and guide you to romance and fever that fly in the face of eternity. She smiles in beauty. Out of nowhere Florent produces a red rose like a magician, and gives her the flower. Vivian is taken by the magic. She doesn't know how he did it. She takes the flower. Yet she loves the little poem that he just recited down by her lips. She puts her arms around his neck. They kiss French. Florent and Vivian kiss French. Music plays on the soundtrack. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian sleeps in coma. Amanda sits in the chair and continues to read Little Women for Vivian. There is a soft smile on Vivian's face. At the entrance, John walks in. He greets Amanda and looks at Vivian. He wants to say something to Vivian, turns his eyes, and looks at Amanda. Amanda understands right away, places the book on a table, and slowly exits the room. John tells Vivian something. We don't hear what he is saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Ext Eiffel Tower, Park, day. Florent and Vivian take a walk in the park by the Eiffel Tower. Vivian, what do you fear in life? Florent, they said, fear is fear itself. But I think fear is the line that we draw between getting what we want and what's taboo. Vivian, explain. Florent, Confucius said, the will to win, the desire to succeed, the urge to reach your full potential, these are the keys that will unlock the door to personal excellence. In the sense, will shapes our characters.
Desire can only take us so far. But there is a thing called passion. It makes the impossible happen. Yet in the meantime, there are moral codes that society draw to sustain life. It's like a road map. Those who take the long route, they arrive late for the party. But those who take shortcut, they get there on time. However, they usually suffer. In suffering, we understand the true meaning of passion, fear, and love. Vivian, that's deep. Florent, what about you? What do you desire above everything? Vivian, true love. Florent, what do you fear? Vivian, I don't really believe in fear. We all are trying to run away from pain. Pain is what causes fear. In the end, those who are adapted to pain will prosper. Florent, Buddha said, pain in life is inevitable but suffering is not. Pain is what the world does to you, suffering is what you do to yourself. Pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. Vivian, Buddha had made mistakes. He abandoned his wife and son to seek the truth. Florent, but he said, there are only two mistakes one can make along the road to truth, not going all the way, and not starting. Vivian, Buddha abandoned physical pleasure. I can't live a day without pleasure. I will kill myself. Vivian sits on top of a bench that happens to be in the park. Florent stands between her legs. Florent, softly by her lips, the only pleasure I know is your lips. He gives her a soft kiss on the lips. He caresses her neck and kisses her cheek. Florent, your cheeks. He kisses her nose. Florent, your nose. He goes down and kisses her knee. Florent, your knees. He kisses her inner thigh. Florent, your thighs. Florent slowly removes her underwear, and gets closer to her lips. Florent, softly by her lips, you as a beautiful young woman. Florent and Vivian kiss French. It begins to rain. People abandon the park and run for shelter. Florent and Vivian continue to kiss in the rain, ignoring everything. He puts her underwear on his head comedically. On the soundtrack, music plays. Vivian then parts her lips and losses Florent's pants as if she were saying, let's do it in the rain. They kiss more passionately. Florent then removes Vivian's underwear from his head and throws it away. He grabs her butt and picks her up. They fall on the muddy grass while kissing. Vivian removes Florent's pants completely, gets on top of him, and rides him seductively as they begin to make love in the rain. Lightnings tear the sky. Thunders roar like Judgment Day. Vivian continues to ride Florent as if her life depended on it. Florent then gets Vivian on the bottom, lifts her left leg, places it on his shoulder, and enters her enchantingly. Vivian is lost in sweet passion. Then comes a police officer named Tony, who happens to be passing by, looks at them from a fair distance. He is carrying an umbrella, waits for them to finish. Florent and Vivian continue to go at it as if there were nobody in the world but them. They then reach their climax and lie flat on the grass as the rain continues to pour down. Florent and Vivian get closer and kiss passionately. As soon as they part their lips, they see Officer Tony standing in front of them with his umbrella. EXT courtroom, day. Florent and Vivian stand before a judge, answering a couple of questions that the judge is asking them. We don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Then Florent's lawyer Hugo Gameiro, 42, walks into the courtroom and approaches the judge. Mr. Gameiro tells the judge whispering, and gives him a paper. Judge looks at the paper. He then tells Florent and Vivian that they are free to go. Florent introduces Hugo to Vivian. Hugo and Vivian shake hands. They all walk toward the exit, talking. Int. Paris Cafe, sunset. Florent and Vivian sit at a table with coffee and croissants. Florent is doing her sketches. Vivian, what did he tell the judge? Florent, he told him I'm an artist. I did the portrait of Marine Le Pen. It was a letter written by her to pardon us. Vivian, who is Marine Le Pen? Florent, she is the president of the National Front, FN, a political party in France. She is currently running for president. They all love her. Vivian, that is something. But we could have easily escaped justice if we got a room. That's why the term get a room invented, because lovers kept having sex in the park. Florent, humorously, I didn't think about that. I just went with the flow. I am guilty as charged. Vivian, joking, I guess we should just be friends. No more sex in the public area. Florent, playing along, it's fine with me, friends forever. Vivian, but who said, between men and women there is no friendship possible? There is passion, enmity, worship, love, but no friendship. Is it Oscar Wilde or Tennessee Williams? Florent, Oscar Wilde. Vivian, I knew it was Oscar Wilde. I played Gwendolyn in Oscar Wilde's play The Importance of Being Earnest in high school. Florent, I think I heard the story before, a man who wished to remain young. And his picture grew old. No. That is the picture of Dorian Gray. The Importance of Being Earnest is about a man pretending to be earnest. So, he can seduce a woman whom he's in love with. Vivian, actually, the play goes like this. The protagonist Jack Worthing is guardian to Cecily Cardew, the granddaughter of the late Thomas Cardew, a wealthy man, who found and adopted Jack when he was a baby in Hertfordshire. Whenever Jack travels to London from his Hertfordshire estate, he says he is going to see his brother, Ernest, whom he made up. While in London, he pretends to be Ernest himself and does what he pleases. Yet Jack is in love with Gwendolyn, who says she can't love any man, except a man named Ernst,
It inspires confidence. Jack presumes to be earnest. Gwendolyn and Jack get engaged. Soon, Algernon, Gwendolyn's cousin, finds out Jack's secret. Jack tells Algernon about Cecily, who is fond of Ernest, Jack's fictitious brother. Algernon comes to Hertfordshire estate to persuade Cecily, pretending to be Ernest. Cecily falls for Algernon, whom she thinks he's Ernest, Jack's notorious brother. Later, Gwendolyn comes to Hertfordshire estate to visit Jack thinking he's Ernest. She tells Cecily that she's engaged to marry Ernest. But Cecily tells her she's the one who's engaged to Ernest. Cecily and Gwendolyn demand explanation why Jack and Algernon pretended to be Ernest. Jack and Algernon tell them they're in love with them. Cecily and Gwendolyn forgive them. In the meantime, Lady Bracknellworth, Gwendolyn's mother, arrives at the Hertfordshire estate unexpected. She tells Jack that she can't approve he's marrying her daughter. Jack says he's Cecily's guardian, and Algernon, Lady Bracknellworth's first cousin, and Cecily are engaged to be married. If she doesn't give him the blessing, he'll not give them the blessing either. At the climax of the story, Lady Bracknellworth confronts Miss Prism, Cecily's governess, who took Lady Bracknellworth's sister's baby 28 years ago. That son is Jack. He is Algernon's real brother. In the end, Jack finds out that his actual name was Ernest. Even though he was pretend to be Ernest all those time, in reality, he is Ernest. Thus the importance of being Ernest. Florent, that's an interesting story. But if you don't mind me asking, if Jack married Gwendolyn, so if Algernon and Gwendolyn are cousins and Jack and Algernon are brothers, then it means Jack married his cousin? Vivian, it's true. Some people tell you it was common for people to marry their relatives in 1800s. I'm not against people marrying their cousins, or anything. But Oscar Wilde might have made a mistake. He focused on wealth instead of love. Jack tells Lady Bracknellworth that Cecily is worth a great deal of money, and will inherit more wealth when she comes of age, to persuade Lady Bracknellworth into giving him her approval. Yet if Oscar Wilde had taken his time, he could have rewritten everything from scratch. Jake is Algernon's brother. Lady Bracknellworth as Jack and Algernon mother's best friend instead of sister, whom Lady Bracknellworth sees as a sister. That's how we did it in high school production of The Importance of Being Earnest. Florent, I see. That way, you wouldn't end up marrying your cousin. Vivian, something like that. Florent, humorously it's good that you stayed away from inbreeding. Vivian, what's that supposed to mean? Florent, nothing. It's a joke. Vivian, what joke? Florent, a joke. You know? Vivian, no I don't. Florent, all that inbreeding thing is a little bit awkward. Vivian, why don't you just say it? Royal intermarriage. Florent, it has nothing to do with royal intermarriage. It's a different subject. I mean, I heard marriage between first cousins double risk of birth defects. That's all. Vivian, so, you thought that's why I ran away, from birth defects and interbreeding. Florent, no. It's not true. Vivian, whatever. I thought you were different. But you're just like the rest of them. She crashes her coffee on the floor, gets up, and leaves. Florent quickly takes out 100 francs, places the money on the table, and goes after Vivian. EXT Paris Cafe, sidewalk, sunset. Vivian walks down the sidewalk. Florent exits and catches up to her. Florent, wait. Florent grabs her arm. They stand face to face. Florent, I swear I didn't mean it like that. It didn't even cross my mind. I have a lot of respect for royal family. I just watched The Wolf of Wall Street a few weeks ago, Leonardo DiCaprio and Johan Hill were joking about marrying first cousin and all. Somehow it reminds me of that. I brought it as a joke. Vivian, it's okay, Florent. Florent, no. It's not okay. I'll never mention the word breeding again. Or I will cut my tongue and throw it on the Seine River. Vivian, it's not your fault. I just felt guilty about everything. I'm sorry. I was just taking my frustration on you. She hugs him. He cuddles her dearly. Florent, it's my fault. Sometimes, I said things that I shouldn't have. Forgive me. He kisses her on the neck. Vivian, there is nothing to forgive. I love you. Florent, I love you too. They kiss passionately. Hint. Florent's villa, bedroom, night. Florent and Vivian make love surrounded by candles. It's sensual, steamy, alluring, and passionate. We stay with them with series cuts as they go at it with various sexual positions. Hint. Florent's villa, studio, night/day. Vivian poses nude on the sofa, covering her vagina with a tulip. Florent does her portrait. Hint. Florent's villa, kitchen, night/day. Florent and Vivian make love in the kitchen while cooking. Hint. Florent's villa, studio, night/day. Vivian poses nude on a chair with style. Florent does her portrait. Hint. Florent's villa, living room, night/day. Florent and Vivian make love on the mattress placed in the middle of the living room surrounded by candles. Hint. Florent's villa, studio, night/day. Vivian poses nude on the bed placed at the studio for the sole purpose of the painting. Florent does her portrait. Hint. Florent's villa, studio, night/day. Florent and Vivian make love on the bed. Hint. Florent's villa, living room, night/day. Vivian poses nude standing next to the window.
Florent does her portrait. Int. Florent's art gallery, day. We see the portraits of Vivian in display. People look at the paintings while conversing and sipping wines. Vivian converses with a good-looking man. Florent mingles with three attractive models. On the soundtrack, classic music plays. Vivian turns her eyes and looks at Florent, who seems to be having fun. Florent turns his face, and catches her eyes. She gives him a beautiful smile. He winks at her. She returns his wink. Int. Florent Art Gallery, later. Vivian stands alone, looking at her portrait. The guests continue to enjoy the gallery. Florent walks up to her and stands next to her. Vivian, you remember that day you mentioned the picture of Dorian Gray? How he wished he remains young and his picture grows old. Florent nods yes. Vivian, would you rather remain young and your pictures grow old, or your pictures remain young and unchanged, and you get old naturally as it is now? Florent, I don't know, a picture could last forever if it's kept in a good condition. It's a reflection of eternity. Yet, we don't know where we go to after we die. We might as well live young, remain young, and die young. Who cares? Let our pictures get old. Vivian, you sound like Dorian Gray, I want to remain young. Let my picture get old, who cares? Live for the movement. Florent, humorously, some people think youth is the number one commodity that one can possess. Vivian, is that how you feel? Florent, no. We all would remain young and wild in hearts as long as we have love in our souls, and if we continue to do what we love to do. But imagine all our pictures get old as we age. When we die, there will be nothing left to remember us. The trace of our existence is gone forever. Icons like Audrey Hepburn and Marilyn Monroe will be myths told through words and oral story. Vivian, actually, Marilyn Monroe died young. She'll still be young regardless. Florent, what if you see her corpse and skeleton on the picture? She smiles in horror. Vivian, that's not fair. Florent, we're not talking about what's fair. We're looking at scenarios. It's like selling your soul to the devil who always keeps on the edge of chaos. The devil never plays fair. He doesn't know the meaning of fair. He gives you something that you desire. He then takes away something valuable to your very existence, like your soul. Vivian, playing along the devil is deceiving. I won't play a guessing game with him. Florent, nobody can outsmart him. He tells you to live your life young and beautiful. In the end, there will be no record of your existence, except your fossil remains. Vivian, playing alone I would still say, it sounds tempting. Young and beautiful. At the same time, it's scary, fossil remains. But I wouldn't worry about it too much. They'll bring me back in the future. They'll just take my DNA and clone me in the lab. Florent, the future is vision of freedom and prosperity. But the question is, do you want to be manufactured in the lab, and go through the same experience? Live young, your picture grow old. You die young seemingly. Your picture shows your fossil remains. They bring you back. The circle would continue like a broken watch that has refused to stop ticking. Vivian, what's wrong with that? It's as good as eternal youth. Florent, you could still achieve eternal youth without being cloned in the lab. Without your picture getting old, without your fossil remains showing in the pictures. Vivian, how is that? Florent, come on. Let's take a walk. I'll tell you everything there is to know about youth. Florent gives her his hand. She takes his hand. Florent and Vivian walk toward the exit. On the soundtrack, music plays. EXT 9th Arrondissement, Sunset. Florent and Vivian take a walk in the most aesthetic neighborhood in Paris at 9th Arrondissement. They are conversing, but we don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Then the music on the soundtrack falls in the background. Vivian, so, tell me, how are you going to keep me young forever, without my picture getting old and my fossil remains showing in photos and paintings? Florent, you're the most beautiful girl in the world. You'll still be beautiful in your 50s, 60s. You'll even be more gorgeous in your 70s and 80s. Plus, you'll have your portraits to remind you that you're the fairest them of all. I might not be around. Maybe I'll come as your guardian angel and fall deeply in love with you in your 90s and 100s. Yet, you'll defy any aging with your beautiful heart. You'll glow brighter than a million suns, and enter different dimensions. You will magically transform into a young woman, in your early 20s, like a fairy tale, and live for eternity without dying. Vivian, that's the sweetest of you. But it's not the same. I'm talking about reality. I'll look at myself in the mirror and miss how I used to look, you know, like my grandmother. I saw her photos when she was young in the 60s and 70s. She was ravishing. Now she got old. She still looks pretty. But time took away her youth like the tree in the autumn. Florent, joking, everything happens for a reason. Imagine if we stay young for a while. A 20-year-old man will have sex with 95-year-old woman. A 25-year-old woman will have sex with 110-year-old man. She gives him a look. Florent, I mean, there is nothing wrong with that, till you look at the video. Then it's a different story. You would see their real ages. Vivian, I didn't know your video gets old too. Florent, videos are series of pictures. They're films. Correct me if I'm wrong. Vivian, playing along, they have digital videos. We could watch 25-year-old man having sex with 90-year-old woman in Blu-rays. Nobody can tell the age difference.
Florent, you're not talking about porn, are you?
Vivian, what if I am?
Florent smiles big.
Florent, no comment.
Vivian, what I meant is why can't we be like cats and dogs?
Florent, joking you mean, we should have sex like cats and dogs, scratching and biting?
She can't help but smile softly.
Vivian, no. I'm talking about aging. You can't tell the difference between old cat and young cat. They look almost the same.
Scientists should take cat's gene, find out what makes them look young compared to human beings. Then apply their secrets to human.
You know, like my cat Lucy. She was 20 years old right before she died.
Cat age, 100.
But she looked the same as if she were going to live another 20 years.
They stand lips to lips.
Florent, what about, you don't worry about having a tail?
Vivian, I'll let you use your imagination with it.
Florent smiles big.
They kiss French.
On the soundtrack, music comes.
Int. Florent's villa, bedroom, night. Florent and Vivian make love surrounded by candles.
It's steamy, alluring, and sensual.
We see Vivian going through intense sexual passion as Florent enters her lusciously.
We stay with them with series cuts as they go at with all kind of sexual positions.
Int. Florent's villa, studio, night. Vivian and Florent sit in the bathtub placed in the middle of the studio. They are surrounded by candles.
Vivian rests on Florent's chest with her eyes closed.
Florent sits behind, reciting a poem, Love in a Mist.
Florent, softly down by her neck sometimes, I'll come as love poems that rhyme, Gazania, a teardrop, and twilight right before nighttime, when flowers in the garden of serendipity vow to blossom forevermore, and make you feel like a femme fatale as if love were a crime, and a butterfly flapping on a sea between the horizon and the offshore, as if a coral rose grew in the air without stem, but thorns that left my soul sweetly sore, which was in covenant with two heartbeat that had existed.
Without time, and tell you what you are is what I'm.
And then kiss your lips while you are lying on rose petals, which I pulled out from roses that I planted in the spring and cut in the fall, and remind thee that thou art the fairest them of all.
Sometimes, I'll come late at night, as bleeding heart that is told in fairy tales and prose, and kiss your sweet lips till you are overdose, while you're sleeping, and dreaming about romance and a pink rose.
Then lick, and bite you lightly from your head to your toes, while you are lying on the beach nude, as if you were told to say no to clothes.
And all of a sudden, the devil disguised as a wind blows on your soft skin as the waves crash on the shore, and whispers anguish and suffering like a cynic that not only like to keep souls cold, but also feast on a heart that guesses.
You begin to think about buying dresses.
I will come out of nowhere, and fulfill your wishes and desires with soft kisses and caresses, make love to you and take away all your pain, discomfort, and stresses.
And when you wake up in the morning, you will fall in love with a chamomile, while your heart is beating faster as if you run a mile.
I will turn into the sun, and burn all my fuels as if love were sentenced to death without a trial, though not before I cook for you breakfast, kiss your lips French, recite you a love poem, and make you smile.
I will then die in a violent death, to immortalize you for a while.
And later, I'll rise from ashes as phoenix that refuses to be kept tame, and make love to you with every sexual position as if love were a game.
We will have sex till we disappear in flame.
Yet kiss your delicious lips till we turn into photons and achieve fame, and then vanish in the murkiness without a shame.
I will then be your candle in the wind, and wobble in your belly tenderly as if I were kicked on the shin, masquerading as a butterfly that quenches its thirst with your intoxicating lips, till I turn into a mere man that has arms and a fin, and drunk with love as if I had been swimming in your blood.
I begin to worship your lips, which hurl defiance at whiskey and gin.
You'll be my Notre Dame cathedral, and a pill that I take when my head and kidneys spin.
And soon or later, I'll commit a beautiful sin, kiss your lips tenderly, and drop in your belly when you feel thin, and the wind will extinguish me under your skin.
But this time, I would kiss your spellbinding lips French without making noise and din, as if I were the third coming of Christ, a messiah with few beard on my chin, and melt your heart till heavens refuse to take me in.
I'll then resurrect as love in a mist and blend with your soul, and promise to treat you above all, my sweetheart, girlfriend, princess, queen, and everything till I take you as my wife.
And make you fall in love with me deeply till it hurts, as if I cut your heart with a knife.
Yet, to bring you true love that will give you the greatest joy, which would last you for the rest of your eternal life.
She smiles in beauty and opens her eyes.
They kiss French.
Ext Paris, street, day.
Florent and Vivian ride motorcycle in the street of Paris.
Vivian is behind Florent with her arms around him.
They are not wearing helmets.
On the soundtrack, music continues to play.
Ext Arc de Triomphe, day.
Florent and Vivian take a walk down the Avenue de Champs-Élysées, eating ice creams and conversing.
We don't hear what they're saying due to the music on the soundtrack.
Florent must have said something humorous.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
They stand lips to lips, talk between soft kisses and kiss French.
They both drop their ice creams in the moment of passion.
Close up, Florent and Vivian.
They continue to kiss as if their lips and tongues were made of their hearts, essences, and souls.
Int.
Tattoo shop, day.
Florent and Vivian walk in.
They come up to the main desk.
Florent grabs a tattoo book.
They look at lists of tattoos that are available.
Vivian picks a red rose tattoo.
Jean, the tattoo artist, approaches Florent and Vivian.
Florent knows Jean.
They hug friendly, greeting.
Florent introduces Jean to Vivian.
Vivian and Jean shake hands and kiss on the cheeks.
They all talk in ease. But we don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack.
Int. Tattoo shop, tattoo room, later.
Vivian lies on her back. Two-thirds of her butts are covered with sick. Jean draws the tattoo on Vivian's skin, right above her buttock. Florent is present. Jean is in the middle of telling them a story. We don't hear what he is saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Then Jean's cell phone rings. Jean looks at his cell phone to see who is calling. He excuses Florent and Vivian and picks it up. Jean says something and hangs it up. Jean tells Florent something and gives him the tattoo machine. Jean tells Vivian that his wife is at a hospital, giving birth. Vivian sits straight and wishes him good luck. Jean kisses her on the cheek. He kisses Florent on the cheek as well in joy. Jean puts on his jacket and leaves. Florent tells Vivian he got everything under control. He has done this before. She trusts him, drops the fabric, and lies on her chest, revealing her curvaceous buttocks. Florent gives her a soft kiss on the buttock and does her tattoo. We stay with Florent and Vivian for a bit.
Int. Tattoo shop, tattoo room, later.
Vivian stands in front of the mirror, looking at her tattoo. She can't believe what she is seeing. Florent added a little cute angel, Cupid. Vivian tells him something as she approaches him. Florent smiles softly. They talk between soft kisses. They then kiss French.
Int.
Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian sleeps in coma. Vivian's mother, father, sister, and brother stand around Vivian's bed, visiting. Vivian's mother talks to Vivian. We don't hear what she is saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Close up, Vivian. She glows in beauty like an angel. EXT Seine River, bridge, day. Florent and Vivian take a walk in the bridge, conversing. Vivian, I am thinking about pursuing acting career.
Florent, that's wonderful.
Vivian, I had a modeling agent in London. He was begging me to turn around my career and pursue acting. He told me he has already got me parts in major movies. But I felt I wasn't ready, want to take few acting classes to boost up my confidence. But ever since I start hanging out with you, all my fears go away, and I feel like I can rule the world like Madonna.
Florent, that's good.
Vivian, what's your favorite movie?
Florent, Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Vivian, that's my favorite movie of all time. That and Roman Holiday. I love Audrey Hepburn more than The Breath of Life. A lot of people tells me I look like her.
Florent, you are more beautiful than her.
Vivian, Audrey Hepburn is beautiful.
Florent, she is beautiful.
Looks at her eyes. You do look like her. You can easily play her if they decide to make Audrey's biopic. But you also have this supernatural fire in your soul like Elizabeth Taylor that sparkles in your eyes, and glows on your beautiful skin. You are both the combination of Audrey Hepburn and Liz Taylor. But still you have a unique look of yours, extremely delicious, there has never been a girl like you in the creation of womankind.
Vivian, you see what I am talking about.
Humorously, if you continue to build up my confidence like that, I might take Hollywood by storm.
Florent, I can't wait to see you in the big screen. You make a terrific actress.
Vivian, I hope so. But I don't want to be separated from you.
Florent, I will come and visit you on the set.
Vivian, joking, they might mistake you with Humphrey Bogart.
Florent, humorously, I am told I look like Humphrey Bogart.
Here's looking at you, kid.
Vivian, you are more handsome than Bogart.
Florent, maybe.
Vivian, it's sad.
He had to let Aisa go at the end in Casablanca.
Florent, he had to let her go.
If Ilsa had stayed with Rick, the bad guys would have won the war.
Vivian, it would have been more romantic if she had stayed with him.
Florent, humorously, they're together in a parallel universe where true love shines brighter than the sun.
Vivian, playing along, I'm sure they are.
Florent, what about? If Jack Nicholson were Rick, he wouldn't have let Ilsa go. Imitating Captain Renault, but what a fool, I'm talking to a beautiful woman about another man.
Vivian, it's all right. I love Jack Nicholson more than life itself. He's as good as it gets.
Florent, humorously, he's a psychopath. I saw him in The Shining when I was a kid. I couldn't sleep for a week.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
Vivian, anyway, I've always dreamed spending the rest of my life with a man who makes each second feel like a romantic novel. You make me feel more beautiful than ever.
Florent, I can't believe I'm walking in Seine River with the most beautiful girl in the world. I have to pinch myself to make sure I'm not daydreaming.
Vivian, I heard that line somewhere, I have to pinch myself, and daydreaming.
Pay me a compliment.
They stand lips to lips.
Florent, darling, I am not the only person on this earth who thinks you're the most exquisite girl in the world. If your eyes were to compare with stars in cloud nine, and anything that is divine, the water lilies and lotus in my heart will forever shine as if they were created with the tears in your eyes so fine, and the camellias would refuse to drink white wine. Beautiful pain makes it present in my soul without a sign. Yet, my heart is covered with sweat and fever as if you had always been mine. Your lips can be mistaken with the roses in the garden of love that goddesses created at the Genesis far from nether, where nothing grow but roses, carnation, tulip, cherry blossom, and heather. They give the breath of passion that is responsible for falling head over heels in love, of which the stars in the universe and creation can't help but come together.
An angel of kiss would gust on your lips disguised as spring weather, and quench its thirst with the delight on your lips till it shades its feather and turns into the good shepherd, but says it is only a bellwether as if its soul were made of fur and leather. Cupid have kissed you while you were sleeping without knowing the meaning of or and whether, as if his heart were tied with a tether. However, could I be the only soul, who feels your joy, pain, heartbeat within my heartbeat as aching as mystery in a love story? Breathing is like a rose petal, a snowflake falling from the sky with the sweetest memory. Ripples on my blood while my heart wrapped around with a barbed wire and set on fire without mercy. I cry when you cry. I smile when you smile. I bleed when you bleed. You are my reward whenever I do a good deed, and punishment when I am unsure neither to admit nor dispute in charge of falling madly, sadistically, deeply, masochistically, and dangerously in love with you, which my soul make me plead, even though I knew you only a couple of weeks as if my heart had forgotten what kind of life it used to lead. Your lips are the breath of passion that I need, and the principle of my very existence that I consider as a creed, in which love is to kiss you with a little bit greed, decrease the speed, then proceed, and allow my tongue to tell you everything I love to read, and promise that I keep in my soul without misdeed. I don't want to part my lips, something in me refused to be freed as if love were created to be fed and feed, and melt your heart till I exceed incantation that put you in a trance better than whiskey, cocaine, and weed. Yet, my heart tells me we've been together since forever before the creation of spell. You are the first perfume that I smell, every love story that I tell, beautiful love that picked me up when I fell, the reason I do well, whenever I think about you that my heart and lungs swell. We had dance in the vast emptiness of air like two butterflies having sex in a hotel, make love and produce the greatest heat known to the universe as if our hearts were kept in the coldest part of hell. Yet, we kiss, kiss and kiss as if our souls were gold and diamonds that we love to steal. Neither of us want to make an appeal nor a deal as if love were a meal. Each cell in our bodies light, and scatter across the universe, as if passion were an explosive device without a shell, which love were something that nobody could offer to misspell, either buy or sell, then turns into star, and tinkles like a bell. We were told true love is infinite reflection of two hearts caught in eternal erotic webs that they had woven in the fabric of the cosmos, which stars are prophets that foretell, and to kiss and heal everything that is unwell, and to make love, and never having to say farewell. We have lived many lives without a goal or an aim as if love had never made any claim. We have set the universe on flame, make love in hidden dimensions where they give no name, have done it with various sexual positions without shame. We create the first erotic game before the invention of sadism and masochism, which S&M is used as nickname. We have involved in bondage, whipped each other with cat-o-nine tails, have done variety of BDSM which I took the blame, have sex, and attain nirvana and universal fame. Yet, my soul confesses passion is to fall deeply in love with you till my heart aches, and never ask questions that start why, and to be inflamed with sexual desire till my eyes cry, my lips dry, my lungs sigh, tongue refuses to wear any tie, and my hands begin to bake a pie. And to feel you with every inch of my soul till I refuse to tell a lie, which crucifixion is to make love to you intertwined like two red heart stardust eclipsing, and to enrapture with carnal pleasure till our hearts grow wings, and fly across the heavens where it's okay to play detective and spy. I keep finding you under my skin, growing in my lungs, liver, kidneys, and every part of my body, and deep in my veins and bone marrows like vine flowers and rhizome, for which you are the most important ingredient of my heart, rose from love that I have worshipped, and built a cathedral in my belly, in which I put my soul crucified on a cross with your image on top of the dome. I have dreamed 1,000 times, day and night, painting your nails with various colors and walking you on water, as if it were a land that was perfectly kept in a rich loam, kissing your lips, which is my favorite thing to do, and brushing your hair with a comb. My quintessence believes the goddess of love created you from love in amethyst, tulip, roses, lily of the valley and cleome. You know me better than novels, fables, fairy tales, and tome, as if you were part of my DNA responsible for accessing information from my genome. You have turned into hex, disguised as fever that loves to roam. Immediately upon, you set my spleen on fire and watch it burn like Rome. Something in me wants to kiss you from your head to your feet, and convince you that is just one of the millions of wishes that I have to complete, give you love that is sweet, and make your heart skip a beat, sing in the rain, and dance with you in the street, always be true, even when I kiss your cheeks to let you know that your smile means everything to me, rather than as to greet, and never cheat. Hold your hand and walk with you in the beach while either vacationing at tropical islands with everyday people and elite, or going on a retreat, which your love is honey that my heart wants to digest, turn into wine that tastes better than whiskey made from rye and wheat, and quenches its thirst till my soul refuses to acknowledge anything that is conceit. I would then make syrup with honey, pour it on your vagina and eat you out without being too modest and discreet, and give you the best oral pleasure of your life as if love didn't know anything about deceit. Inasmuch as, you have already turned my liver into foam, for which the reason that everything you touch turns into a sparkling star that would make diamonds seem chrome. Meanwhile, you make my heart your home. I am diagnosed with I love you to infinity and beyond syndrome. When I am with you, our friends rejoice in upbeat, and our enemies fall in defeat. Hereinafter and by means of this, I would cuddle you next to my heart naked and feel that beautiful heat, which is produced when two lovers' erotic needs sexually meet, or rather when we kiss, caress, make love and get lost in dopamine, acetylcholine, endorphins, and oxytocin that our hormones secrete, of which love think it is only a treat. We would then prove love wrong by making steamy love till we sweat salt, in which every water in our bodies couldn't help but deplete. All of a sudden, we find ourselves in each other's arm again as it were forbidden to talk about things that had to do with goodbye. Yet, this time, I would make love to you till every star fall from the sky,
and kiss your lips as if I were about to take my last breath and die. Resurrection is peace of mind gone wild, which divinity is to float like dandelions that have exiled, and mysteriously to find ourselves in gladiolus and magnolia as if love had never been the subject of reviled. Soon, we realize we are flesh and blood that is far from defiled. I would cuddle you next to my heart till we produce warm temperature that make the fire in hell mild, and to transcend into nothingness, far from life that is orderly styled. I can't wait to solve the mystery of your beauty and eternal youth and kiss that is believed to be medicine to the soul, heart, and even mind that occasionally acts like a software, which in rare conditions, information refuses to be complied. I think of your face when I get riled, of which my soul would never get enough of you even when problems piled, and I have never said I should haven't fallen in love and smiled while I am beguiled, as if my heart wanted to play like a child. Whereas enlightenment is to burst into phenomenon and scatter like two mystical gold nebula across the infinite darkness and endless night, and dance masquerading as a knight and a bride who happens to be wearing a gown that is white. Every time we see each other, it's passion at sight. We would kiss French as if we're in spotlight, and light the cosmos sweeter than the twilight, to kiss more intimately till we forget what is wrong and right, as if we were dancing in the moonlight, seduce, tempt, court, and live for each other till the end of time and life and existence that once upon times were summed up with thrive, survival of the fittest, and fight and flight. We would kiss, make love, and hold nothing back as if we were the quintessence of love that shines brighter than supernova and daylight. Vivian, that's something. They kiss French. Note, the poem will be kept short. Vivian, I like true love is infinite reflection of two souls caught in eternal erotic webs that they had woven in the fabric of the cosmos. Florent, it must be the Paris air. They resume walking. Vivian, Paris is a city that exists in a parallel universe. Its aesthetic beauty and magic can only reveal to those who have fallen in love deeply and unconditionally. Florent, joking, I think Paris is one of the most overrated city in the world. Florence is more romantic than Paris. Vivian, I've never been in Florence. I can't talk about it. But to say Paris is the most overrated city in the world is a crime that's punishable by crucifixion. Florent smiles in wonder. Florent, I'm kidding. Florence is beautiful. They can take my liver and bury it in Cathedral of Santa Maria del Fiore after I die. But my heart goes out to Paris. They can literally open my chest, take my heart, burn it, and scatter the ashes across Paris while I'm still alive. I can live with artificial heart. Yet above everything, my soul belongs to you, this life, next lifetime, and for eternity. Vivian smiles in beauty. Vivian, you're the most romantic man I have ever met. But let me ask you a question, why does it feel like the end of the world when we don't get what we want? Like earlier, I had a craving for banana split. But I didn't want to eat anything. All of a sudden, I thought the world is going to end in a massive earthquake. I then had a coffee. I felt peace of mind. Florent, I don't get it. You had a craving for banana split. You thought the world was going to end. You then had coffee and felt peace of mind. What coffee has anything to do with banana split? Vivian, I substituted my craving of banana split with coffee. I basically tricked my brain into accepting coffee, instead of banana split. Banana split has 1650 calories compared to coffee, which has only 100 calories, no fat and cholesterol. Florent, I see. Vivian, I'm not calorie freak or anything. I just thought I should take care of myself as much as I can. We see a girl about 17, standing on the edge of the bridge. She is about to jump. Florent and Vivian look at her. Vivian, what's that girl doing? She's going to jump, my God. Pantu, the girl. She takes pills that she was holding in her hand, and jumps into the river. Vivian screams instinctively. Florent gives her his cell phone. Florent, call the police. Florent quickly runs down the bridge as Vivian calls the police. Florent jumps into the water. Florent swims as fast as he can, freestyle, where the girl is drowned at. On the soundtrack, French songs plays. Florent goes under the water. Underwater. Florent swims underwater. We see the girl floating unconscious. Florent swims toward her, places his arms in her armpits, and begins to ascend with her. Ext Seine River, day. Florent emerges out of the water with the girl and swims toward the shore. People, who happen to be in the area, give Florent their hands helping. They pull them out of the water. Florent doesn't waste another second, quickly gives the girl CPR, and chest compressions. There is no reaction. Florent repeats the emergency procedure a couple of times. Vivian stands and looks at them in puzzlement. Medium shot of Florent giving the girl cardiopulmonary resuscitation, and chest compressions. Then. The girl coughs out water and pills. The crowd clap their hands in delight. In the meantime, police and paramedics arrive at the scene. They push through the crowd and come up to the girl with a medical stretcher. The paramedics examine the girl. They pick her up and place her on the medical stretcher. In the meantime, two police officers ask Florent few questions in French. Vivian comes and stands next Florent. Florent takes her hand as he answers a question. The paramedics place the girl inside the ambulance, get in their ambulance, start the car, and drive away as Florent continues to answer questions. In the soundtrack, a French song plays. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, emergency room, day. We see a typical emergency room commotion, doctors and nurses walk up and down. Some are aiding patients.
Others are looking at medical charts. At the waiting room, patients sit in chairs. They are waiting to be seen by doctors. At the entrance, Florent and Vivian walk in. They come up to the circulation desk. Florent asks a nurse to give him information of the girl. The nurse types something in her computer and tells him the telegram. It's a figure of speech, but she tells him what he wants to hear. Florent thanks her. He takes Vivian's hand. They walk toward the camera. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, ER, the girl's room, day. The girl sleeps unconscious. All kinds of medical tubes are attached into the girl, heart monitor, glucose, oxygen, etc. Florent and Vivian walk in. They look at the girl. The girl is so young and innocently beautiful. They don't understand why she tried to kill herself. Vivian is overwhelmed by sadness. Florent and Vivian hug. Vivian's eyes fill with tears. Florent kisses her on the temple. A tear escapes from her eye and drops down by her cheek. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian sleeps in coma. A tear leaves her eye and falls by the side of her cheek. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room and corridor, day. A Secret Service man sits in a chair, guarding Vivian's room. Two more Secret Service men stand at the main corridor, making sure the place is secure. Elevator. The elevator's doors open at the corridor, revealing Florent and Vivian. Vivian is wearing a sexy nurse outfit and a blonde wig. Florent is wearing a white coat. He is carrying a medical chart. Hallway and corridor. Vivian and Florent exit from the elevator. Florent greets the Secret Service men with a nod. Vivian's nurse outfit is suggestive. We can see her cleavages and sexy legs. The Secret Service men check her out. Florent and Vivian walk down the hallway. Florent greets the Secret Service man at the door. Florent and Vivian enter Vivian's room. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian sleeps in coma. Florent comes closer. The portrait Vivian stands in the back. Florent looks at the comatose Vivian. He gives her a soft kiss on the lips. Florent, I love you. The portrait Vivian's eyes fill with tear. A tear escapes from her eye and falls by her cheek. In the meantime, a tear leaves from comatose Vivian's eye and falls by the side of her face. Vivian walks into the medical restroom. Medical restroom. Vivian stands in front of the mirror and dries her tears. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Florent continues to look at the comatose Vivian. Then at the entrance, John walks in. Florent is caught off guard. John, good afternoon. Florent, good afternoon. I'm Dr. Reno. John, greeting John. They shake hands. John, how is she doing? Florent, she's doing fine. John, she's showing a lot of progress, isn't she? Florent, yes, she is. John, Dr. Remy said she should come out of it any second. She has showed some movements. Vivian, who is hiding in the medical restroom, looks through the opening, between the door and the frame. Florent looks at the comatose Vivian. Florent, she'll come out of it. She is taking a long nap. John looks at the comatose Vivian as well. There is pure beauty, grace, and peace on her face. We can't explain it in words. It is a miracle. Florent looks at the portrait Vivian, and makes a comic face as if he were telling her, what should I do? I'm not a doctor. Vivian smiles in beauty. In the meantime, the comatose Vivian beams in a soft, beautiful smile. The smile quickly disappears from her face in heartbeats. John, what about? I'm told she smiles a lot. I saw her smiling a couple of times myself. Do people in coma smiles, is that common? Florent, it's common. She's just having beautiful dreams. Excuse me. Florent excuses John and walks toward the medical restroom. Medical restroom. Vivian opens the door a little bit wider for Florent. Florent enters in ease. Note, they are talking in whisper. Vivian, what are we going to do? Florent, I don't know. Vivian, he'll recognize me. Florent looks at a door. Florent, where is that door leads to? Florent walks up to the door and opens it. On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, next room, day. It is a medical room, next to Vivian's room. It is empty. We can assume John might have ordered the room to be unoccupied for now. He doesn't want the paparazzi to come through that door, pretending to be visitors and take Vivian's photos. But that is a different story. Florent and Vivian enter and walk toward the exit. Florent looks through the door opening. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, hallway, day. Secret Service man walks up and down, making sure it is safe. Florent and Vivian slowly exit. They walk down the opposite side of the hallway. The Secret Service man looks at them suspiciously, but says nothing. Corridor 2 and elevator 2. We see two new Secret Service men. They are securing the area. Florent and Vivian pass by them. Florent presses a button. The elevator doors open. Florent and Vivian enter. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, elevator 2, day. Florent presses a button. The elevator doors close. The elevator moves down. Florent and Vivian get closer lips to lips, talk between soft kisses, and kiss French. EXT/Int. Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day.
Florent and Vivian drive in the wine country of Champagne Ardennes, France. On the soundtrack, a French song plays melodiously. EXT Patrick, and Monica's Villa, Day. It is a marvelous house by the vineyard. It looks like a castle, chateau. There is a water fountain. Beautiful garden. Sculptures and a pond. EXT Patrick and Monica's Villa, Florent's Mercedes convertible, Day. Florent and Vivian come driving and park the car next to the water fountain. They get out of the car and walk to the door. Florent rings the bell. Int. Patrick and Monica's Villa, Day. A maiden named Sophia comes up to the door and opens the door, revealing Florent and Vivian. Florent, bonjour. Sophia, bonjour. Sophia steps out of the house. Sophia and Florent kiss on the cheeks. Sophia, in French, you brought a new girlfriend. Florent smiles softly. Florent, introducing them in French, this is Sophia, Vivian. Vivian, bonjour. Vivian gives Sophia her hand. Sophia, bonjour madame et monsieur. Sophia takes Vivian's hand, greeting. Sophia, in French, I've seen him with a couple of attractive girls. Yet, you're by far the prettiest them of all. Vivian, in French, thanks. Sophia, in French, come in. Florent and Vivian enter. They all head toward the living room. Int. Patrick and Monica's Villa, main living room, Day. Florent, Vivian, and Sophia come up to the main living room too. Sophia excuses them and walks toward the kitchen. Monica Price, 29, holding a glass of wine and a cigarette, comes up to the living room, from living room too. Monica, joyously Florent. Florent, under his breath, hi. She hugs him. They kiss on the cheeks. Monica, humorously, I had a crazy dream last night. You were doing my nude portrait. All of a sudden, I found myself walking naked in Sahara Desert mysteriously, saw you standing with a rose, and approached you. I then asked you if you had a cigarette. You said you thought I quit. I told you I quit, but that didn't mean I couldn't smoke whenever I feel like it. You said, if you say so. You turned the rose into a cigarette magically to impress me, lit it with a lighter and gave me the cigarette. I was kind of impressed. But not to be outdone, I put the cigarette in my vagina, inhaled the tobacco, and exhaled out the smoke with my nostril with style. You thought I was just showing off. Or could it be your mind playing tricks on you? Regardless, I took another drag with my vagina and give you a shotgun, you know, breathe the smoke in your mouth. We then kissed French. But it's shame. I waked up in the middle of the night. Jokingly to Vivian, he took the cigarette from my hand while we were kissing, and burnt my buttock. He is sadistic. Don't be fooled by his sexy eyes. Florent can't help but smile softly, so does Vivian. Monica looks at Vivian's eyes with seduction. Florent, introducing Vivian. This is the infamous seductress Monica that I was telling you about. Vivian, pleased to meet you. Monica, the pleasure is mine. They kiss on the cheeks. Monica, come on. I want to show you something. Monica takes Florent's arm. Florent holds Vivian's hand. They all head toward the next room, art studio. On the soundtrack, French music plays. Int. Monica and Patrick's Villa, art studio, Day. It is an enormous art studio, as big as two football stadiums. We see all kinds of unique sculptures, strange and abstract paintings, half photograph and half paintings, sculptures that are made of all kinds of things, artistic paintings that are drawn on animal skins, woods, all kinds of rare canvases. Stuffed animals mixed with paintings and photographs, etc. Monica, Florent, and Vivian walk down the studio. Monica is telling them about the arts. We don't hear what she is saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Vivian is overwhelmed by their beauty, delicacy, power, and rareness. She is speechless. Then the music on the soundtrack falls in the background. Monica, I'm having a party and gallery show in Paris at Luxembourg Palace on Saturday. I want you to come. Florent, sure. Vivian can't take off her eyes from the arts. Vivian, they're provocative. Monica, Florent painted some of them, referring to a huge abstract painting, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. Florent, Patrick, and I painted that abstract painting. Eternal Sunshine of Spotless Mind after the movie starring Jim Carrey and Kate Winslet. Vivian, it's arresting. Monica, Florent is the greatest living artist in the world, if not ever. He did Kate Winslet. Everybody thinks it's a photo. Vivian, that's what I keep telling him. His paintings look like photos. He's gifted. Monica, gifted is understatement. He's a god. Florent, humorously, if you ladies are going to sweat me like that, I'll have no choice but to sleep with both of you at the same times. Monica, joking, since threesome going out of style, you're not talking about hardcore S&M sex, are you? Vivian, humorously, maybe, he will spank our butts with a cat's nail tails. Florent smiles in wonder. Florent, playing along, I would be honored to fulfill your deepest sexual fantasies. Monica, didn't I tell you not to be fooled by his sexy eyes and six packs? Vivian, I couldn't help it. Florent, Vivian, and Monica smile softly and resume walking while looking at breathtaking paintings, sculptures, and various artworks. On the soundtrack, music plays. Int. Patrick and Monica's Vineyard, Day. An established shot of Monica and Patrick's vineyard in early sunset. EXT Patrick and Monica's Villa, Garden, Sunset.
Florent, Vivian, Monica, Monica's boyfriend Patrick, 39, Sarah, 26, Matthew, 34, Ben, 32, and Julia, 29, sit at a table enjoying wine and all kinds of French cuisine while talking about philosophy. They are artists, writer, actress, and filmmakers. Julia looks at the beautiful twilight. Julia, isn't the sun beautiful? Ben, it's splendid. Patrick, the sun is the ultimate source of energy on Earth. I remember Miss Kirsten Carey, my fourth grade teacher, one of the sexiest biology teachers you would ever meet in your life, talking about photosynthesis, how plants convert light energy from the sun into chemical energy. And how carbohydrates are synthesized from carbon dioxide and water. And oxygen is released as a waste product. Plus, how we breathe in oxygen and exhale carbon dioxide. Someday we'll make Mars habitable by administering artificial greenhouse gases, and populate the red planet. It's all branded in my memory. Florent, Vivian knows everything there is to know about living in Mars, and traveling beyond the solar system. Why don't you tell them about the sun's fate, sweetheart? You told me it's not going to be around forever. Vivian, it's nothing. I mean, someday the sun will burn out its fuel and consume the Earth. We have 5 billion years to prepare. You know, not only make Mars habitable for now, but we have to find other planets that supports life, create satellites that maps the cosmos to the last details, and calculate which planet supports life out of the myriad natural objects, billions of galaxies, and countless stars, and make spaceships that travel at the speed of light as well as capable of teleportation like Star Trek, and eventually populate the universe. We'll then move beyond the observable universe, inhabit neighboring universes and travel beyond multiverse. Or we can just create artificial wormholes in the lab, and travel directly to parallel universes, and keep our hope of conquering infinity. Sarah, that sounds genius. But what about, do you think aliens exist? Could Earth be the only planet that support life? Vivian, I doubt it. There are billions of stars in our Milky Way galaxy just like the Sun, and countless planets that orbits those stars. Our Milky Way is just one of 100 billion of galaxies in the universe. There could be intelligent lives that exist in other planets. To say Earth is the only planet that supports life is we don't know anything about the universe. Ben, who knows? Just think about it, there are 9 planets in our solar system, and Earth is the only planet that supports life. If we were closer to the sun like Venus, we'd have burned to death. And if Earth were a little bit far out of the sun like Mars, we'd have frozen to death. Earth happens to be in the right place, at the right time. Why is that? It must be an explanation. Maybe, the universe is created by some kind of divine power. Sarah, who's that divine power? Don't tell me it's a man with long white beard, who got bored, decided to create heaven and earth. He then came to earth in the form of flesh and blood and died on the cross for our sin, resurrected from death, and returned to paradise wherever that is. Ben, it could be anybody. It's beyond our understanding. But think about it. Life has come this far. I'm not even talking about the formation of planets and stars, and how the universe forms 14 billion years ago. Some of us have no idea how complicated the structure of cell is, how it divides, metabolizes, make copies of itself, the genes, DNA, RNA, etc. Life didn't come out of nothing. We see a maker mark. I believe God created us in his own image, so we could go out and be the greatest. Matthew, that has nothing to do with extraterrestrial life in other planets. Take for example dinosaurs. Let's not carry it away with the structure of their DNA, RNA, genes, connection of their brains and all. However, they appeared 231.4 million years ago. They were the dominant terrestrial vertebrates, and thrived for 135 million years, till they were extinct 66 million years ago. Humans have only been on the planet for about 200,000 years. Are they special? And if God created life in Earth, what's going to stop him from creating lives in some other places? Julia, maybe, God has already created life throughout the universe. It's up to us to find them and make the first contact. Monica, that would have been something. But what's the purpose of life? Why are we here? Where do we go after we die? Patrick, joking, life has zero purpose. It's an accident, freak of nature. We're here to show up. Eat, drink, dance, have sex, and die. Then go to heaven and live for eternity whether if we do bad, or good. They have small laughter. Ben, I kind of disagree with you. I believe in good versus evil. All those spiritual forces that manifest in your soul. It's not only if you do good, you'll be rewarded. And if you do bad, you'll be punished. But there is a spiritual battle for the souls of mankind. In the end, good will prevail evil, and all those destructive forces will be punished in hell. Monica, you can say it's good versus evil, crucifixion and all those spiritual battles that are waged in the subconscious mind. But take any person, open his or her brain and remove his or her frontal lobe. That person will stop reasoning altogether. There are documents, like in the case of Phineas Gage. He was hit by a large iron rod. The rod penetrated his left cheek, tore through his brain, and exited his skull, destroying his brain's left frontal lobe. His behavior completely changed. Prior to his injury, he was described as a shrewd and smart businessman. After the accident, he just became violent due to the damage he sustained on his brain. Do we have the right to judge him?
Do you think God should punish his soul for eternity?
Matthew, I think everything is relative. The Bible talks about the Ten Commandments: thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not kill, etc.
Yet I just read Crime and Punishment by Fyodor Dostoevsky 3 weeks ago. The protagonist killed an old lady and her sister with an axe. He lures you with his theory, to sympathize with him. You even feel his pain and desperation. You cheer for him, despite the fact we're taught a person should not take another person's life. Murder is a crime. And then again, you look at the history of mankind, killing has been part of human evolution. War has claimed more life than stroke in the last 300 years alone. The question is not if killing is wrong, but when do we learn to live in harmony? There will be more bloodshedding, unless societies change their point of view toward money, power, violence, sex, and technology. You know, I don't want to sound like a communist. But we have to channel negative energy and turn them into positive, like converting all those nuclear weapons into something constructive, you know, use the energy to launch rockets. Travel to space, discover new worlds, like Mademoiselle Vivian said, planets that support life, find extraterrestrial lives whatever they look like, try to understand the deepest meaning of the cosmos, the concept of soul. What's consciousness? I'm talking about the core purpose of life. Why are we here? The biggest picture. Life has direction. Life has purpose. It's hard to say what it's at this early stage. But it's alive and kicking. We might say heaven and hell, reincarnation. God, Allah, Buddha, and all that's abstract. But a billion years from now, everything we know about life will completely change, like how we thought the Earth was the center of the universe, before Nicolaus Copernicus and Galileo proved us wrong 400 years ago. Someday, we could be multiple places, and do multiple tasks. All those quantum theories become our reality. Patrick, if I could be multiple place and do multiple tasks, I'll make love to my girl and her copy at the same time, you know, two separate places, at the kitchen and in the bedroom simultaneously till my balls hurts. The guests laugh moderately. Patrick kisses Monica on the temple. Monica, it's like you're having sex with me and my twin sister. Don't you think that's considered cheating?
Patrick, no. Nothing like that. I'm making love to you and your copy, except your copy and you are the same persons. You feel the pleasure in your brain without participating in the act, and while participating in the action. It sounds ironic. But there is nothing irony about it, however, superlative sexual pleasure.
Monica, how do you know that?
Patrick, I just assumed.
You know, if I'm in two places, making love to you and your copy concurrently, I want you to experience all the pleasure in the cosmos till you cannot take it anymore.
Patrick kisses her on the lips.
Julia, humorously, she is the luckiest girl in the world. But what about, is it possible to travel in time?
You know, to create time traveling machine like Back to the Future?
I don't mind going back in time and change few things, or travel to the future, and see how the future unfold.
Maybe, they will find cure for cancer and design cars that fly in the air.
Patrick, Back to the Future is one of my favorite movies of all time. It's possible to travel back in time and make few changes. However, there is a grandfather paradox. Suppose you go back in time and kill your grandfather. Would you exist?
Ben, nobody can answer that correctly. Some astrophysics say it won't change anything.
If you go back in time and kill your grandfather, you will continue to exist no matter what. You only killed his copy out of the infinite copies of your grandfather in hidden quantum universes.
Monica, what about, suppose I created a time-traveling machine June 10, 2017. I wait for 1 year, 2 years, 3, 4, 5 years. I then go back to the time-traveling machine, and travel back in time. The time-traveling machine can only take me back as far as June 10, 2017, which is the day I designed it. I think that's the best time machine we can make in the future, without quantum universes, because if we would have created a successful time-traveling machine, we could have seen at least an article in a newspaper, or magazine, even internet covering the story, about a person who came from the future.
Matthew, that would be a wonderful film plot. A man comes out of nowhere, claims he is from the future. He traveled back in time with a time-traveling machine that he designed without anyone's approval, and he is planning to return to the future. However, in order to return to the future, he has to build a new machine from the scratch. He just popped out from the thin air. He needs all of things. At the same time, he falls in love with an attractive girl. Let's say they hit it off. He tells her everything, the truth, how he came from the future. She begins to help him getting the things that would allow him to travel in the future, despite the fact she thinks he might be insane. Nobody has ever traveled in time in the history of humankind. Yet, she is a rocket scientist. Some part of her heart tells her to be optimistic. He could be from the future. He has already shown her the formula. It's a matter of time before he completes the time-traveling machine. Yet, she doesn't care about the time-traveling machine. That can wait. Perhaps, it is not important. She is head over heels in love with him. She just wants to spend quality time with this handsome stranger. Of course we have to create conflict. She had a boyfriend prior to involving with Mr. Future. Suppose he is an astronaut. He was in space, counting the stars, you know, conducting all kinds of researches, including mission to Mars while orbiting Earth. Later, he returns home to his beloved family and friends.
His girlfriend welcomes him with open heart seemingly. She told Mr. Future it was wrong to involve with him in the first place. It was fun till it lasted. She doesn't want to hurt her boyfriend feeling. They should end it with high note and remain friends. He tells her it's fine. He doesn't want to come between her and her fiancé and lets her go. Meanwhile, she tells herself I must stay away from him and stop fantasying about him. I am over him. But it's a lie. She still loves Mr. Future very much. She can't stop thinking about him. She gets up in the middle of the night, gets in her car, and drive to his house. They kiss and make love. The next day, she told her boyfriend she can't see him anymore. She is in love with Mr. Future. The trouble just begins without a warning. Her boyfriend, who felt betrayed, did a background check on Mr. Future. Who is this guy? What does he do? Where did he come from? He finds out he has no social security, no past history, or nothing. He concludes he must be a spy and reports him to FBI. They arrest him. Later, they question him if he was a spy for France. He is using the girl to steal information to travel Mars. He tells him. He doesn't care about Mars. As odd as it sounds, France was the first country to set a man on Mars. They beat USA by few days. He is building a time-traveling machine that would allow him to go back where came from. The federal agents don't believe him and keep him in a minimum security jail till they sort things out. They search his house and find all kinds of formulas. The head of NASA looks at the formula. It is amazing. He has never seen anything like these in his life. He tells FBI and the president of the USA he does not give a fuck if he is a spy, or a demon from hell, or an alien from unknown planet, or a genius created in a lab. But he wants Mr. Future to finish the project. They free him. Not total freedom, they made a deal with him. They told him they don't care where he is from, but he is welcome to conduct researches. However, he has to report all his findings to NASA. He thinks it's better than to be locked in jail without committing any crime. He continues to work on the project with the help of the girl, whom he couldn't get enough of. She is addicted to him as well. All they do is cook, dance, make love, and work on the time-traveling machine. In the end, he finishes it. Everybody is present. The government tells him he can neither take anybody nor test it on human. Instead, they make a test on cat. The cat disappears before their eyes. It's time for Mr. Future to go back to where he came from. He doesn't want to part from the girl. At the same time, he must leave, or they will arrest him and put him in a prison. The government spent billions of dollars on the machine. They don't know if it works or not. He has no choice, gets on the time-traveling machine, and starts the machine. Right before he presses the button, the girl runs toward the time-traveling machine to join him. When one of the guards is about to shoot her with a tranquilizer, the head of NASA stops him. Just let her go. Mr. Future opens the door for her. She gets in the time-traveling machine, they kiss French. He then presses the button. They travel to the future. Later, he would build a successful time-traveling machine that allows them to travel back and forth as they please. The end. Monica, that's a wonderful story. Florent told me Vivian is an actress. You can cast her in the female lead role. Matthew, it's weird. I might have created the story as I go. But I had her for the female lead role from the beginning to the end. I was looking at her eyes. I think I might have created the story to impress her. No offense to you, Free. Florent, no, I am not offended at all. I am thrilled. She can easily pull it off. I have faith on her. Matthew, I will write it when I get free time and let her know. She is my number one choice. Vivian says nothing. Sarah, anyway, talking about the future. What about artificial intelligences, will they replace human in the future? Ben, it's possible. Computers are performing tasks in few seconds that used to take humans years. There are software applications that allow us to do almost anything. In the sense, they have already replaced us. And talking about quantum mechanics, it'll give them a jump start, to think for themselves and learn new things on their own terms. Sarah, what about parallel universes, is the universe finite? Or there are multiple universes? Florent, Vivian can answer that. She was telling me how there are countless universes. If we travel far enough, we'll run into our copies. Vivian, I mean most scientists say the universe started in singularity as a tiny dot. Then it burst forth in a big bang, creating everything we know in the cosmos, including space and time. If space and time were created at the Big Bang, the universe could be finite. Yet the universe is expanding faster than the speed of light. According to Neil Turek and Paul Steinhardt's The Ekpyrotic Model, the universe came about from the collision of two brains. Our universe is just one of countless universes in the hyperspace. Julia, that's one of the most thought-provoking scientific theories. The Ekpyrotic Model. But I have a question, how did the universe actually begin? What are some of the theories of creation? Vivian, some cosmologists say the universe could have been created in white dwarf after death of stars in a black hole, which existed in a parallel universe. Others says the universe started out as a tiny entity similar to the Big Bang theory. However, it expands gradually. At some point, it'll contrast back to the original form. It'll then expand back. The cycle continues for eternity. And there are cosmologists who say the universe actually formed in quantum fluctuation. A tiny particle appeared out of nowhere in quantum vacuum, containing all the information in the universe, including space and time.
Then inflation took over, inexplicable fast expansion of space, spreading the information evenly. Then the universe cooled. Matters closed in under the force of gravity, forming stars, galaxies, and planets. Countless new universes are born each second, even here right in front of us in hidden dimensions.
Ben, that's interesting.
Yet, I think the question is not how the universe began. But it's what happened before the beginning? If our universe is one of the countless universes, created in quantum fluctuation. Singularity, Big Bang, black hole, collision of two brains, and others, what's the starting point of creation, before the universe, before singularity, before multiverse, before space and time? Where did all these things come from?
Vivian, I think nobody has that answer.
Our brains aren't wired enough to grasp the deepest laws of creation. It is like teaching calculus to a dog. It would never understand the mathematical study of changes.
It is the same thing. It will take mankind another 14 billion years to develop brains that might answer some of the biggest questions of the universe, including how we got here, where did the universe come from?
What's time?
What's space, hidden dimensions, multiverse, consciousness, infinity itself?
Yet let's assume God created everything.
Some say God was there at the beginning.
He was there before Genesis.
He'll be there at the end.
I am talking about theology.
Since it's a collection of information gathered by the subconscious mind that is responsible to our spiritual psyche passed through generation, it might help us understand few things, including awareness, intuition, and our very existence till we figure it out scientifically.
Suppose God will be around after the end.
He's eternal.
No beginning and no end.
But how could anything have no beginning and no end?
Everything we know in this world goes through entropy, from order to chaos.
They follow second law of thermodynamic.
We can't unscramble an egg.
We can't live our lives in reverse.
At some point, things will wear away.
Change is inevitable.
And as long as there is change,
there is a beginning.
As long as there is a beginning,
there is an end, unless everything in the universe is illusion.
Julia, that's an interesting point.
But I doubt if everything in the universe is illusion.
We just don't understand how God works.
The universe might be expanding.
Space is infinite and real.
But time could be illusion.
The past, the present, the future happens at the same time.
Patrick, that's something.
But if the actual space is real and infinite, why are we stranded in this planet?
We're here for a short time.
It feels like yesterday, I was 10, playing soccer with my friends.
Now I'm about to turn 40.
It's scary.
You know, despite the fact the past, the present, the future happens at the same time, I feel lost sometimes.
Sarah, you don't look 40.
You look 28.
Patrick, I've lived my life to the fullest.
I'm grateful for Monica.
I wouldn't trade a single day that I spent with her for eternity.
She is keeping me young with sex.
Kisses her on the cheek.
When I am around her, I forget to grow up.
Yet, I miss the energy of youth.
There is no fear in it.
I wish I could go back in time and run like the wind.
Sarah, talking about innocence.
The mind replaces it with few sins.
We become aware of everything.
We grow self-conscious and feel accountable for everything.
I think responsibility is the biggest curse conflicted in human brain.
Julia, I couldn't agree more.
Patrick, don't get me wrong.
I don't mind being responsible for the well-being of my girl.
If I continue to treat her with love and respect, she'll remain beautiful forever.
Patrick kisses Monica on the lips.
Ben, that's one hell of responsibility.
But let me tell you a story.
I was a kid, about 11.
My parents were building this guest house, right across the main house in Paris.
I wrote my name on the wall.
So, it'll stay forever.
Then I knew what I did was wrong.
I was going to get a first-class beating.
I also knew I couldn't undo the mistake.
It was fresh clay.
I would ruin everything.
I thought the smarter thing to do was to write my brother's name on the wall as well.
So, my parent would think it was my brother who wrote the names.
My father saw the names.
I got a call.
I couldn't lie.
My name was written bigger than my brother.
In the sense, I felt immortal for a moment.
But first, I had to face punishment.
My brother had already gotten a beating for what I did.
My father asked me why I wrote it.
I told him I wanted to immortalize myself.
He was kind of impressed somehow.
I only got a mild beating to warn me not to damage things.
Humorously, or perhaps, it could be my brother took half of a beating for me.
That is a joke.
Nonetheless, now I think about it.
We all are kids in hearts, writing our names on walls.
But the walls have changed.
They become stars.
It's immortality.
A million years from now, people would look at the names, and say who wrote this.
Who painted that, what was Michelangelo thinking when he painted on the Sistine Chapel ceiling?
What was in Jane Austen's mind, heart, and soul when she wrote Pride and Prejudice?
Leo Tolstoy when he penned down Anna Karenina, did he pop his fingers, like one of his character Alexei Karenin?
And Florent, when he painted Love in a Mist, could he have foreseen the future?
Maybe we are thinking about the people that matter to us the most before we meet them, like a sixth sense.
Or perhaps we are thinking about immortality in the past, present, and future, deep in the subconscious of our mind.
Marcus Garvey said, God and nature first made us what we are, and then out of our own created genius we make ourselves what we want to be.
Follow always that great law.
Let the sky and God be our limit and eternity our measurement.
They all smile moderately. On the soundtrack, music plays. They continue to talk. Vivian looks at Florent. He gives her a wink. We stay with them for a bit, and pull out dexterously.
Int.
Patrick and Monica's vineyard, sunset. The sky is covered with sparkling stars. We see a bright moon. Florent and Vivian take a walk in the vineyard. Both sides of the street have lampposts made for the sole purpose of a night walk.
Vivian, how do you want to be remembered?
Florent, humorously the greatest ever.
Vivian, joking that doesn't sound too ambitious.
Florent, playing along maybe I'm not a very ambitious person.
Vivian, you're the best artist I've ever seen.
I think you're way better than Picasso and Leonard da Vinci.
Florent, Picasso is from another planet. He has his own unique style of drawing.
Leonard da Vinci is a Zen master.
However, I like Gergen, a Renaissance painter. He inspired me in so many ways than other painters.
But sadly, he died at young age.
Vivian, I think time has changed since the Renaissance.
I've seen your paintings. I couldn't tell the difference between your paintings and photographs.
They're breathtaking.
Florent, there is no secret.
Like I told you before, we have advanced painting equipment and inks that weren't available during the Renaissance.
Vivian, that has nothing to do with it.
I think you exist in a parallel universe, which happens to be occupied by the same space and time with our universe.
It's light years ahead of our civilization.
You have a special privilege to access both worlds.
Florent smiles in amusement.
Florent, thanks. That's the best compliment I've ever received in my life.
But does this special privilege give me the right to fall in love with you unconditionally?
Vivian, you tell me.
They stop walking and stand lips to lips.
Florent, I don't know anything about parallel universe, or light years, and knowledges that have given birth to women and men.
I don't know which come first, the egg or the hen, and never understood why the commandments are not 3 instead of 10, to love and be loved, to kiss and be kissed, and to write you a love poem with a pen. But I feel you're the soul placed in my heart before the breath of life, time, and space.
All I think about, sense, see and dream about is your beautiful face. As if I were lost forever and ever deep in my soul without a trace.
She smiles in beauty. They exchange luscious kisses.
Vivian, that's poetic.
But what does Ben mean by love in a mist? Is there anything you want to tell me about?
Florent, it's nothing, this old artistic painting that I did from memory long time ago.
Everybody thinks it's a masterpiece.
She looks exactly like you.
Vivian, where is it?
Florent, I sold it.
Vivian, to whom did you sell it?
Florent, an art collector, the same guy who sold the boat to me.
There is a silent moment.
They continue to walk.
Vivian, I want to see it.
Florent, he lives in Paris.
We can drive back to Paris and see it tonight if you want to.
They stop moving and stand lips to lips.
Vivian, seductively by his lips will go tomorrow.
Tonight, I want you to make love to me.
Florent, under his breath as you wish.
They kiss French.
On the soundtrack music plays.
Int.
Monica and Patrick's villa, studio, night. Vivian and Florent make love on a mattress that is placed in the middle of the studio surrounded by candles.
It is one of the most romantic love scenes in the history of cinema.
We stay with them with series cuts mixed with the paintings and sculptures.
Int.
Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day.
Florent and Vivian drive back to Paris.
Florent is behind the wheel. Vivian sits in the passenger seat. They are conversing in ease. But we don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack.
Florent says something romantic.
Vivian smiles in beauty. She unbuckles her seatbelt, comes up to Florent, and sits on his laps.
They kiss while driving.
Ext Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day.
The car goes off the lane.
Int. Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day.
Florent places the car in the correct lane.
Close up, Florent and Vivian. They continue to kiss.
In the meantime, Florent makes sure the car remains in the right lane.
Ext Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day.
An established shot of Florent's Mercedes moving with Florent and Vivian.
Montage, Paris. The Eiffel Tower, Café Les Deux Magots in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, skyscrapers of La Défense, Notre Dame de Paris, the City of Paris, panoramic view of the Isle Saint-Louis, the Place de la Concorde, Avenue de Champs-Élysées, Seine River, Paris bridges and many more.
Ext Squillacy's Château, day.
An established shot of Squillacy's Château. It looks like Winter Palace.
We see beautiful scriptures, water fountain, a pond, and a magnificent garden.
Int.
Squillacy's Château, guest waiting room, day.
Florent and Vivian sit at the waiting room, sipping coffee.
We see amazing abstract and artistic paintings on the wall.
The waiting room looks like an art gallery itself.
Then Squillacy, 56, comes up to the waiting room.
Florent and Vivian put their teas aside and get up to greet him.
Squillacy shakes Florent and Vivian's hands.
He escorts them to the main art room.
Int.
Squillacy's Château, art collection room, day.
We see all kinds of amazing paintings and sculptures throughout the room.
They are protected by laser beams.
Squillacy, Florent, and Vivian walk in.
Squillacy types something on the security device and turns off the laser beams.
Squillacy, Vivian, and Florent walk down the room and come to an art that is covered with a curtain.
Squillacy opens the curtain.
We see a nude artistic painting of a girl who looks exactly like Vivian titled Love in a Mist. Vivian can't believe what she is looking at. It looks like a portrait of Vivian, herself.
Vivian, when did you paint this?
Florent, 6 years ago.
Vivian, is it a portrait?
Did someone, who looks like me, pose for you?
Florent, no, I did it with my imagination, a girl that I dreamed about.
Vivian continues to look at the painting in wonder.
Vivian, it's unbelievable, as if I were looking at myself.
You're amazing.
Florent smiles softly.
Vivian can't take her eyes off the painting.
EXT Cafe, sunset.
Florent and Vivian sit in the pub with glasses of wine.
Florent, why are you quiet?
Vivian, I'm still thinking about the painting.
How did you do it?
I mean, how can anyone paint a person without ever meeting them? I wasn't even famous 6 years ago. I was in high school.
Florent, I must have seen you somewhere.
Vivian, where?
Florent, I don't know.
Maybe somewhere in Paris.
Vivian, 6 years ago I was in Montreal.
Florent, maybe I watched you on TV by accident, or you did some modeling for fashion magazines, like Vanity Fair or Vogue.
Vivian, I didn't do any TV in Montreal.
I started modeling in London while I was in college.
Florent, so how do you explain it?
Vivian, I didn't paint it.
You painted it?
Florent, I saw her in a dream. I got up in the middle of the night and began to paint her from memory. It took me a year to finish it.
Vivian, she looks exactly like me.
Florent, I don't know what to say.
Vivian, maybe you have the power to see the future, some kind of sixth sense that nobody knows about.
Florent smiles softly. Out of nowhere, Florent produces two opera tickets like a magician.
Florent, here, I have two tickets for opera.
He gives her a ticket.
Int. Pellegarni, night. Carmen by Georges Bizet is in progress.
Florent and Vivian, who is wearing a bewitching light purple Valentino gown, sit in a box, watching the show.
Florent looks at Vivian.
She is into the opera. But she senses that Florent is looking at her. She turns her eyes, gives him a beautiful smile and turns her attention back to the opera.
Florent smiles softly, and turns his attention back to the opera.
We stay with Florent, Vivian, and Carmen, Act 2, for a bit.
EXT Paris, Champs-Élysées, day.
Florent and Vivian take a walk in Champs-Élysées while conversing. On the soundtrack, we continue to hear the opera.
Florent and Vivian stand lips to lips, talking between soft kisses.
Florent then tells her something seductive.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
They kiss French.
Int.
Paris Hotel, bedroom, night.
Florent and Vivian make love.
It's sensual, steamy, and passionate.
We stay with them with series cuts.
On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously.
Int.
Paris Hotel, rooftop, night.
A scenic view of Paris in the night.
Florent and Vivian sit in the bathtub that is placed on the roof surrounded by candles.
Vivian rests on Florent's chest.
Florent is behind, reciting a poem from memory.
Florent, softly down by her neck, let me fall in love with thee, as if I had been waiting for your love in vain for a long time yearningly, and thought about making an advance, while standing with my hands on my belly with aching stance.
Seduce your heart, and show you the art of romance, as if fever loved to hire a freelance.
Kiss your lips till your knees beg for second chance.
Hold your hand and teach you how to dance.
I would give you sweet love that is above just, so I could get closer to your heart disguised as a gust.
Then plant soft kisses on your luscious lips, and solve the mysteries of your heart, which your beautiful soul and love entrust.
I would then act loving, caring, tender, and a little bit robust.
Tender love is only to warm your cold feet, when hankering innocently gets caught up in falsehood and deceit.
Yet, craving has refused either to be on good terms with a lie, or cheat.
I would kiss your lips, light your soul and free your heartbeat.
Then make love to you till your fear and pain fleet, as if love were trick and treat, which sex is an excuse to quench our thirsts, feed our hungers, join our souls in erotic intimacy, and produce the greatest heat.
Passion is a must.
It's to shoot for the stars, kiss intimately, caress, and to inflame with desire as if we created from stardust.
Thus, in love and romance, let's you and I trust, kiss, caress, make love, and lust, till our souls leak and combust.
Let's have sex, as if nothing is created to rest, but burst like cosmic dust, and to do it with various sexual positions and make up for everything that is unjust.
When you think that you know everything there is to know about love and the affair of the heart that I might unfairly enhance, French kiss, and the scent of roses in France, undress you courteously, kiss your belly, go down, spread your legs, and stimulate your clit with my tongue, as if I were counting money metaphorically, in which love were far removed from finance, give you the sweetest orgasm, and put you in a trance.
I'll then turn your heartbeat into love in a mist that's worthwhile, kiss your eyes, nose, cheeks, lips, and collar bones, like a rose petal floating on a blue Nile, and make love to you as if I were reading your profile. Let's take the art of sexual intercourse to the next level, make love till all the stars in the skies leave in exile.
And the nights go out of style.
I would then hold you next to my heart and take you to a place where the sun is daisy.
Dreams come true when you blink your eyes, which the stars in your irises sparkle across infinity, as if love were nothing but the product of divinity.
But my soul transcends beyond creation, the grace of love, and sempiternity.
I love you to the depth of my soul,
nothing short of rapture and ecstasy, same as often love injects passion in flowers, blossoms faithfully, gloriously, and mysteriously, and attracts a butterfly that flaps for hours. To kiss your lips whenever you feel like you run out of powers, till the snowflakes in your heart steam, sweat, and turns into fever, and fall in your belly disguised as a teardrop, at the same time, descend from the sky camouflaged in precipitations and showers. Let's dance, make love, recite poems, and compose dreams, rhapsodies, thrills, and the greatest love stories ever told, and above everything, kisses that are ours. Vivian smiles in beauty. She opens her eyes. They kiss French. On the soundtrack, music comes. Int. Paris Hotel, bedroom, night. Florent and Vivian make love. We stay with them with a series cut. EXT Paris Hotel, terrace, morning. Florent and Vivian sit in the terrace, next to the Seine River. They are having a fancy breakfast, honey almond polenta, eggs, vanilla cream French toast and fruit dishes. We see few customers enjoying their breakfasts in the background. On the soundtrack, music continues to play. Vivian asks him a question. Florent says something romantic. Vivian smiles in beauty. She gets up, comes up to Florent, and sits on his lap. They talk between soft kisses and kiss French. EXT Parc des Princes, PSG vs AC Milan, day. Florent and Vivian sit in the middle of thousands Paris Saint-Germain FC fan, watching PSG vs AC Milan. They are wearing Paris Saint-Germain FC jerseys. PSG scores a goal. PSG fans go frenzy. Florent and Vivian celebrate too. But they are doing it with French kiss. Int. Saint-Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, day. Vivian remains in coma sleeping without a worry in the solar system but love. Vivian's mother, father, grandmother, sister, and brother stand around Vivian's bed visiting. Vivian's father tells Vivian something virtuous. We don't hear what he is saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Close up, Vivian. There is a soft beautiful smile on her face. EXT Luxembourg Palace, sunset. An established shot of Luxembourg Palace in the sunset. Int. Luxembourg Palace, party, night. We see some of Monica and Patrick's unique sculptures and strange paintings in display. Businessman, elites, aristocratic, producers, movie stars and models mingle. Some are looking at the artworks. Others are talking while sipping champagnes. At the entrance, Florent and Vivian, who is wearing a stunning red Versace gown, walk in. Monica, who is talking to her brother, Sean, and his wife, Olivia, looks at them. She excuses her brother and Olivia and walks up to Florent and Vivian. Monica, hey. Florent, hi. Florent and Monica kiss on the cheeks. Monica, bonjour, gorgeous. Vivian, under her breath, bonjour. Vivian and Monica kiss on the cheeks, greeting. Monica, Patrick just flew to Los Angeles to shoot a movie, leaving me to do everything by myself. I felt lost. Florent, it looks like you're having a great party. Monica, you know me, I'm not here to sell the arts, but to throw the greatest party in the solar system and have fun. Monica takes his arm. Monica, come on. I want to introduce you to my brother Sean and his wife Olivia. Humorously to Florent, she's pretty. You're going to fall in love with her. She might even pose nude for you, but don't sleep with her. She is a whore. Florent smiles softly. He holds Vivian's hand. Monica, Florent, and Vivian walk up to Sean and Olivia. On the soundtrack, music plays. Monica introduces Florent and Vivian to Sean and Olivia. They all greet and begin to mingle. We don't hear what they say due to the music on the soundtrack. Int. Luxembourg Palace, party, later. Florent converses with an attractive model named Christina. At the other end of the palace, Vivian and a good-looking man named Sylvain talk. Christina and Florent are getting along fine. In the meantime, it seems there is a good chemistry between Vivian and Sylvain. However, Vivian can't get enough of Florent, turns her eyes, and looks at him. Florent catches her eyes and gives her a wink. Vivian smiles softly, excuses Sylvain, and walks up to the bar. Meanwhile, Florent excuses Christina and walks toward Vivian. Florent comes up to the bar and stands next to Vivian. On the soundtrack, the music plays softly. Florent, hi. Vivian, what's up? Florent, nothing much. Vivian, to the bartender, may I have scotch, gold label? The bartender looks at Florent. Florent, I'll have what she's having. The bartender pours scotch in two separate glasses and places the drinks in front of them. Florent and Vivian take their drinks and come up to the nearest stand table. Florent, how are you? Vivian, I am fine. And you? Florent, I couldn't be more animated than I am now. Vivian, that is good. They take sips and put their drinks on the table. Florent, are you having fun? Vivian, sort of. Florent, humorously, what do you mean by sort of? Sort of like you're just having fun, or sort of like you're having the time of your life? Vivian, mockingly, I'm having a time of my life. Florent smiles charismatically. There is a silent moment. They take sips from their drinks. She then. Vivian, who's the girl you were talking to? Florent, she said her name is Christina. Vivian, what does Christina want? Florent, what do women usually want? Vivian, I thought you were an expert on women.
Why don't you tell me?
Florent, the French says a woman understands another woman more than a man understands his own mother.
Vivian, I think she's a slut.
A woman of no importance.
Florent, humorously she seems nice.
I wouldn't go far and call her a woman of no importance.
Vivian, are you defending her?
Florent, no. I'm not.
She gives him a look.
Florent, okay, maybe a little bit.
Vivian, I won't hold it against you.
I like a man who stands up for women.
It's sexy.
But tell me, what were you talking about?
Florent, she wanted to know what I do.
I told her I'm a painter.
She asked me what kind of painting I do, style, you know, if he is artistic or abstract.
I told her, artistic paintings and portraits.
It seemed she wanted me to do her nude portrait.
Vivian, did she ask you?
Florent, she didn't have to.
She is a model, mentioned she had done a couple of nude photographs.
And how she is comfortable posing nude.
Vivian, I knew she was a slut.
Florent smiles in amusement.
Florent, what about you, who was the guy that you were talking to?
Vivian, he's nobody.
Florent, what do you mean he is nobody?
It looked like you were into him.
Vivian, were you jealous?
Florent, humorously a little bit.
Vivian, his name is Sylvain. He thinks he can seduce any girl and take them to a bed.
Florent, did you fall for it?
Vivian, joking, I don't understand the question.
Florent, did the idea cross your mind?
Vivian, can you make it clearer?
Florent, playing alone, did you want to have sex with him?
Vivian, not really.
There is a pause.
Florent looks at her eyes suspiciously.
Florent, humorously, you aren't lying, are you?
Vivian, playing along, what make you think I am lying?
Florent, I didn't say you were lying.
But your pupils are dilating.
Vivian, your pupils tend to dilate in the night when there is no sufficient light.
Florent smiles softly.
Florent, you want to dance?
He gives her his hand to dance.
Vivian, sure.
She takes his hand.
They come to the dance floor and begin to dance slow.
Florent, humorously, I could be wrong, but I was told your pupils tend to dilate when you're sexually aroused.
Vivian, I am always sexually aroused when I am with you.
I get wet just looking at your eyes.
They exchange long delicious French kiss and part their lips.
There is a silent moment.
They continue to dance slow.
He then.
Florent, did you eat anything?
Vivian, no, I didn't.
You told me to fast.
Florent, I was only kidding.
Vivian, I knew you were kidding.
But I didn't want to eat anyway.
There is another silent moment.
They continue to dance.
He then.
Florent, you look hungry.
Vivian, I'm starving.
Florent, you want to go out and eat?
Or you want to take a boat ride on the Seine River?
Vivian, I want to eat first.
Then take a boat ride.
Florent, why don't we eat while taking a boat ride?
I made reservation.
I called a chef to come to my boat and make you anything you want.
Your favorite French cuisine, Flemish and chocolate souffle.
They're waiting for us.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
Florent and Vivian kiss.
On the soundtrack, music plays.
EXT Seine River, Florent's boat, floating, night.
Mousa navigates the boat.
Florent and Vivian sit at a table that is placed in the deck, enjoying French cuisine.
Flemish, ratatouille, tart tatin, salade nicoise, and chocolate souffle with a bottle of red wine.
On the soundtrack, music continues to play.
Then the music falls in the background.
Vivian, scientists say everything in the universe is created with strings.
Tiny vibrating energy.
Different melody determines different fundamental particles.
According to M-theory, there are 11 dimensions.
Two strings grew the size of membranes, and collided with each other, creating the universe that we take for granted.
Not only are there countless universes, but also limitless parallel universes that exist in the same space and time with our universe.
There could be intelligent lives right in front of our eyes in hidden dimensions.
You know, a civilization that is billions light years ahead of us.
Their eyes are brighter than the sun.
Their skins shimmer like silk.
Like I told you before, they look like angels.
But they're humans who have evolved into beautiful creatures.
They're capable of flying like Superman and Wonder Woman.
Would you find that romantic?
Florent, I think your eyes are billions of times more splendorous than the stars in the skies.
Your lips are more intoxicating than carnations and the Garden of Hesperides.
Your skin is softer than spring air.
Your face is more exquisite than Cleopatra.
It glows brighter than the moon in summer nights.
Your body is the definition of pulchritudinous.
It's slenderer than Venus.
Trillion years from now, humans might colonize the universe and go beyond the observable universe.
They might inhabit multiverse and evolve into angels and beautiful creatures.
But you'll still be the fairest them of all.
They'll talk about you like we talk about Aphrodite, Helen of the Troy and Psyche, as if you were a mythological goddess, the archetype of beauty, true love, and perfection, if not a biblical figure that was created before the stars in the skies.
She smiles in beauty.
Vivian, it keeps getting better and better.
Florent, under his breath, what can I say, you bring the best in me.
Vivian, let me ask you a question.
If you could have one superpower, what would it be?
Florent, I wish I had the power to turn into pure energy, you know, something that just keep going without ever getting exhausted.
Vivian, why is that?
Florent, so,
I can keep up with you on bed and give you some of the best orgasms of your life. I've never met anyone quite energetic like you.
Vivian, is that right?
Florent, you're like a wildfire.
Vivian, I have a reputation for being lascivious.
I love sex.
I can't help it.
But don't be hard on yourself. You have more stamina than a Wolverine. You have given me the best orgasms of my life.
Florent, playing along, I don't believe you.
Vivian, you're a sex machine. No man will ever give me sweeter triple X orgasm than you in million lifetimes.
Florent, I'm honored to hear that. But what about you? If you have one superpower, what would it be?
Vivian, the power to access hidden dimensions.
Florent, why is that?
Vivian, I'll visit places that can't be found in our planet.
Florent, that's something. But what if there are no hidden dimensions, what you see is what you get?
Vivian, there is a scientific proof that hidden dimensions do exist. Scientists at CERN collided particles at the speed of light with the Large Hadron Collider. Some of the debris escaped to extra dimensions. They measure the amount of energy before the collision and after the collision, and find out there was less energy after the collision.
Florent, that's interesting.
Vivian, I'm kidding. They haven't found extra dimensions yet. But hopefully, they'll find them the next few years. Right now, they're focusing on finding the Higgs boson, the building block of the universe. Yet, if they just upgrade the Large Hadron Collider, I mean, you see, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. Showing him with her hands, takes two particles, moves them around, and collides them near the speed of light. But if they build a new Super Hadron Collider on the moon that collides particles, not near but at the speed of light, without the restriction of gravity, they can easily find extra dimensions, quantum gravity, and all kinds of supersymmetries. That is just my theory. I could easily be wrong.
Florent, I'm sure they'll build a new collider on Mars in near future and find something.
Vivian, anyway, let's change the subject. I don't want to talk about science. I just wish the night last forever.
Florent, you don't mean it literally, do you?
Vivian, humorously, yes, I mean it literally, sort of.
Why?
Florent, if the night lasts forever, soon, or later you'll get bored of it.
Vivian, what would you have done to entertain me?
Florent, a lot of things.
Vivian, like what?
Florent, we'll sail around the world and make love in every beautiful city.
Vivian, that can be done in a year if we just take a plane.
I'm talking about eternity.
Florent, in that case, I'll build a spacecraft that is capable of teleportation, and make love to you in every exotic place throughout the multiverse.
Vivian, that's tempting, but what about, would you strip off your clothes and dance exotic for me?
Florent smiles in wonder. He didn't know he was being set up.
Florent, I didn't see it coming. But I would do anything to entertain you.
Vivian, I want you to remove off your clothes one by one, and dance exotic for me now.
Florent, I'm out of shape.
I'll do it some other time.
Vivian, you're right. I saw you doing clapping push-up this morning. You're as ripped as Bruce Lee.
Florent, a little bit surprised I didn't know you knew Bruce Lee.
Vivian, of course, I know Bruce Lee. I did martial art when I was a kid. My parent took me to a martial arts school in Montreal. I trained for a year. I know the basic techniques, how you apply them in controlled fighting situations and how you react under pressure.
Florent, you're scaring me.
Vivian, don't change the subject. I want you to dance for me now.
Florent, I promise I'll get in shape and dance for you someday.
Vivian, little bit pissed such yourself.
Florent smiles softly. He looks at her eyes tenderly for a moment.
He then.
Florent, what about you, if the night lasts forever, what would you have done to entertain me?
Vivian, since you refuse to entertain me, why should I entertain you?
Florent, I didn't refuse.
I promise I'll get in shape and dance for your birthday.
Vivian, I don't care about my birthday.
You're in shape. I want you to entertain me now.
Florent, what about, instead I'll tell you a joke.
Vivian, no, I hate jokes. They're designed to degrade people. They have evil intention.
Florent, I don't know if jokes have any evil intention.
But they say laughter is the best medicine for the soul.
Vivian, I'm talking about jokes in general.
Take for example. A kid drops a banana peel in purpose, causing a man to slip and fall on his ass. Most of us find that funny. But it's misfortune.
Florent, what about Charlie Chaplin?
His comedies are meant to make us laugh.
He created The Tramp.
Movie like City Light, Modern Time, and Gold Rush are timeless. And William Shakespeare's Midsummer Night's Dream. It's tended to be smart, funny, and entertaining. I doubt if there is any evil intention behind Midsummer Night's Dream.
Vivian, comedy is nothing but tragedy, disguised in wit and humor.
Florent, I think the world would have ended in tears long time ago without comedy.
Vivian, never mind. I could be wrong. But I prefer you strip for me than act like a clown.
Florent smiles big.
Florent, since you brought the idea in the first place, what don't you strip for me?
Vivian looks at his eyes seductively. She then gets up, walks up to the laptop, stereo, changes the French song and plays Super Freak by Rick James.
Vivian takes off her clothes one by one, stripping while dancing exotic with Super Freak. She looks like the sexiest thing we have ever seen in our life.
Florent couldn't believe what he is looking at. He thinks she is a pro.
We can't blame him. It seems she has done it a million times. Just when we think we have seen it all.
On the stereo, Cream by Prince plays melodiously. Vivian gets lost in the music, and continues to dance as if she were about to have orgasm. Vivian completely removes her clothes, except her Victoria's Secret underwear while dancing seductively. Florent is mesmerized. He is in a fantasy world. Vivian then sits on Florent's lap and gives him a lap dance, grinding her butt on his groin. She then takes his hand and places it in her underwear as if she were telling him to finger her. Florent stimulates her clitoris as she continues to give him a lap dance. Vivian reaches climax, gets up, turns around, and sits on Florent's lap, facing him while dancing exotic. They kiss French. Florent picks her up, removes the plates and glasses on the table, crashing them on the floor. Florent places her on the table as they continue to kiss passionately. Florent caresses her neck, slowly removes her underwear. Vivian unbuttons his shirt and opens his pants. Florent and Vivian kiss and begin to make love. Int. Florent's boat, floating, bedroom, night. Florent and Vivian make love surrounded by candles. It is steamy, alluring and passionate. We see Vivian going through intense sexual passion as Florent enters her. It is one of the most romantic love scenes in the history of cinema. They take it to another level. We stay with them in series cuts as they go at it with various sexual positions. Int. Florent's boat, bedroom, night. Vivian lies on her back nude, her head is resting on a pillow. Her eyes are closed. Florent, who is nude as well, paints on Vivian's front part, breasts, chests, belly, etc. Vivian, with closed eyes I saw your sketchbook. Did you sleep with all those women? Florent, I slept with some of them, for the sake of physical pleasure. It doesn't mean anything. Vivian, what about? Who is that girl with the stigmata of Christ? I keep seeing her everywhere. Florent, she was my girlfriend. She moved to LA to pursue singing. We decided to take time off from each other due to a long relationship. Florent, who broke it? Vivian, she broke it? Actually, it was my fault. I was supposed to call her. But I didn't. Vivian, how come? Florent, I don't know, I just forgot about it. It was her birthday. The next day, I called her and apologized, but she said she didn't want to speak to me anymore. It was a long relationship. Perhaps we should see other people. I said fine. She smiles softly. There is a silent moment. She closes her eyes. She then. Vivian, with closed eyes do you love me, Florent? Florent, I could tell you the greatest love story ever told. How God created a woman from a man's heart while he was wide awake, and breath fire on her. I could recite you a poetry about how her eyes gave birth to the stars across the cosmos. I could write a Bible how the man died on a cross for her, and resurrected from death after she kisses him on the lips. I could tell you how he painted the sky orange, gold, and blue. But they mean nothing if I spend a single night without dreaming about you. She smiles softly. Vivian, with closed eyes that means you love me. Florent, more than eternal life itself. Vivian smiles in beauty. She opens her eyes, gets up and looks at the painting in the mirror. Vivian, it's beautiful. Florent, I'm not done yet. Vivian returns to the bed and lies on her back. Florent continues to paint. There is a silent moment. She then. Vivian, free. Florent, softly what's it, sweet love? Vivian, under her breath give me oral pleasure. Florent paints on her collarbone, kisses her nipples, slowly paints between her breasts, and kisses her belly. Florent then goes down, gives her a soft kiss on the vagina, and begins to give her oral pleasure. Close up, Vivian. She is dying with pleasure. Vivian then pulls his hair gently and brings him closer to her lips. They kiss passionately and begin to make love. On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously. Int. Florent's boat, bedroom, morning. Florent and Vivian make love. It's seductive, steamy, and passionate. We stay with them with series cut. EXT Florent's boat, bathtub, sunset. Vivian poses in the tub that is placed in the deck surrounded by candles. Florent does her portrait. Florent then puts down his brush aside and approaches her. They talk between soft kisses. Florent then enters in the tub. They kiss French. Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, night. Vivian sleeps in coma. There is a soft beautiful smile on her face. Amanda sits in the chair, reading Jane Austen's Emma aloud. Then at the entrance, John walks in. John, hello. Amanda, hi. John, how she's doing? Amanda, she seems happy, always smiling. Amanda gets up. John approaches Vivian and looks at her. Amanda puts the book on the table and exits in the background. John, hi, Vivian. Last night I had a dream. I was in Westminster Abbey alone. You walked into the church, wearing a beautiful wedding gown. You looked like an angel of God. You asked me why I wanted to marry you. I told you, because I love you. I can't see myself with anyone but you. John kisses her on the forehead. John, the doctors told me they heard you talking in your sleep. They had no explanation how that happened. But it's a matter of time before you wake up. We'll get married as soon as we get back to London. There is a pause. He then. John,
I heard about the two paparazzi who were following you. I swear they'll pay dearly.
EXT restaurant, day.
Jake and Luke sit at a table in a pub drinking beers. The restaurant is located next to the Seine River.
Jake, I can't believe they're blaming us for her coma.
Luke, I told you never to sell those accident photos.
Jake, come on, Luke.
You were there.
They were 100 people photographing the accident with their cell phones.
They have no evidence that we were following her.
We were just happened to be in the area when the accident occurred.
We came to La Ville de Lumière for Paris Cinema International Film Festival.
We stick with our story.
Luke, I felt guilty.
Prince Diana died, because she and her Egyptian lover wanted to get away from the photographers.
Now Vivian is in coma, because we tried to take her photographs.
I'm considering leaving the business for good and doing something else.
It's not worth it.
Jake, don't be hard on yourself, man.
We were just doing our jobs.
Accident happens like nightmare.
Imagine if all photographers are blamed for taking photos of celebrities, how is the popular culture going to influence ideas about fashion, lifestyle, and icons?
TV?
Local news?
CNN?
BBC?
All they talk about is war and domestic problems, a guy shoots his girlfriend.
A civil war broke out in a country that you don't give a damn about.
We make celebrities larger than life figures.
They need us as much as we need them.
It's business.
No photographer killed Princess Diana.
She was murdered by MI6 and the royal family.
First, the driver was drunk.
His blood alcohol content level was more than 3 times France's legal blood alcohol limit.
Second, the accident might have been caused by British intelligence MI6 to kill Princess Diana, and stop her marrying her Muslim boyfriend Dodi Fayed.
It is nothing but a sabotage.
You know how the British are.
They are sensitive when it comes to religion.
They fought with France, Ireland, Sweden, Russia, Spain, Turkey, India, Saudi Arabia, China, and USA over Catholicism, Protestantism, and all sorts of religions.
Luke, I thought USA fought with UK over independence.
Jake, I brought USA as a joke.
They're nothing but British hooligans, who rebelled against their moms and dads, who were formal, so they could behave badly without having to sing God Save the Kings and Queens bullshit.
Luke sees Vivian and Florent as they get out of Florent's boat.
Luke, wait a second.
Am I imagining?
Or that's Vivian with that guy over there.
Luke points his finger at Vivian and Florent as they walk down the harbor.
Jake removes his sunglass, gets up and looks at them.
Jake, it's her?
It can't be, what the fuck is going on?
We just saw her at the hospital sleeping in coma this morning.
Luke gets up and looks at her.
Luke, it could be her twin sister.
Jake, Vivian has no twin sister.
Luke, it could be some chick who looks like her.
Jake, I know Vivian like no other person in the world.
That's her.
Jake quickly grabs his camera from the table and begins to take her photographs without wasting another minute.
Jake, this is going to make it on the cover of Time, the princess faked her coma.
Luke, what, you think that's Vivian?
Jake, I just told you I know Vivian like no other soul in the solar system.
I'll swear on Bible that's her.
Jake continues to take her photographs.
Then out of nowhere come 3 British Secret Service men and approach Luke and Jake.
Secret Service Man 1 takes out his badge and shows them.
Secret Service Man 1, Interpol.
We'd like you guys to come with us.
A van comes driving and stops next to Jake and Luke.
Jake, what did we do?
Secret Service Man 1 shows them the gun in his holster.
Secret Service Man 1, just get in.
Secret Service Men 2 and 3 escort Jake and Luke into the van.
Secret Service Men 2 and 3 enter in the van as well.
The door is closed.
The van drives away.
A black Mercedes comes driving and pulls next to Secret Service Man 1.
Secret Service Man 1 opens the door and gets in the passenger seat.
The Mercedes drives away.
Florent and Vivian look at the cars, the van and the Mercedes, as they drive by them.
Int.
Abandoned building, 4th floor, day.
Jake and Luke sit in 2 separate chairs tied up.
The 3 Secret Service men stand behind them.
We see 2 huge male lions in a cage.
We also see all kinds of torturing devices on a table, some of them look like they were used in the medieval time.
John approaches them.
John, I was told you guys were following her before she got into accident.
Jake, we were only doing our jobs.
John, you almost killed her.
No respond.
John takes out a cigarette, lights it, takes a drag, and breathes out the smoke.
John, you can't go around harassing people.
There is a consequence for your action.
Jake sees the lions, turns his eyes, and looks at torturing devices.
Jake, what are you going to do with us?
Are you going to torture us?
Or are you going to feed us to the lions?
Either way, you will not get away with it.
John, do you know harassing the future queen and attack on the monarch are considered high treason?
Convicts were tied to a hurdle and drawn by horse.
Then they were hanged, almost to the point of death.
Followed by emasculating, disemboweled, beheaded, and quartered, chopped into 4 pieces.
I thought about skinning you alive and removing your organs one by one while you are still alive, and feed you guys to those lions, but I'm just going to burn you alive.
You can scream if you want to.
These lions are spoiled.
They like their food roasted.
John gives a Secret Service named Bruce a sign.
Bruce pours benzene on them.
Jake, wait, I got something you might want to see.
I have photographs of Vivian with some guy.
John gives Bruce a sign to stand back.
Jake, we were following her. We thought she was having an affair.
Luke looks at Jake as if he were saying, what are you talking about?
Montage, Paris. The Eiffel Tower, Café Les Deux Magots in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, skyscrapers of La Défense, Notre Dame de Paris, the city of Paris, panoramic view of the Isle Saint-Louis, the Place de la Concorde, Avenue de Champs-Élysées, Seine River, Paris bridges and many more.
Hint.
Paris, Jake's photo studio, day. Jake, Luke, and John are at Jake's photo studio in Paris. Secret Service Man 1 is present. His name is Ryan. We see the latest photos of Vivian and Florent on a glass counter. John looks at a close-up photo of Vivian.
Jake, I'm telling you that's her.
I know Vivian. Here, I have her old photos. Jake produces her old photos from his file.
Jake, look at it, the same eye color, the same smile, the same shape of face, the same alluring lips.
John looks at Jake, turns his eyes and continues to look at the photographs.
John, these photographs are taken on June 4th, this noon.
Vivian is sleeping in coma.
How did this happen?
Jake, I don't know how it happened.
Luke, it could be her twin sister.
Jake, Vivian has no twin sister.
John, I know her parents very well. They would have told me if she had a twin sister.
Jake, besides, if she has a twin sister, the girl would have come forward.
Vivian is the most popular person in the solar system.
Here. Jake takes out three photos of Vivian look-alike.
Jake, there are three Vivian look-alike in the world.
First photograph.
Jake, Elizabeth Lewis.
Born April 14, 1993, British Columbia, Canada. But she moved to Sydney, Australia when she was 12. She got her biochemistry degree 2 years ago at University of New South Wales. She's in medical school at the University of Sydney. He shows him second photograph.
Jake, Jessica Moore.
Born September 9, 1991 in Philadelphia. Lives in LA. She works as computer consultant for IBM. He shows him third photograph.
Jake, Lindsay Hopkins, born July 30, 1992 in Liverpool.
She moved to London and became a professional Vivian impersonator. She makes £10,000 a week in public appearance, photo shots, and impersonation. Still none of them look like Vivian, except this girl. Referring to Vivian who comes out of the portrait, I don't believe she's another Vivian look-alike. There is something suspicious going on.
John looks at the photo of Florent. He thinks he has seen him somewhere but he is not 100% sure.
John, whatever it may be. I want you to destroy all the photographs. The doctor said Vivian should come out of coma any minute.
We're getting married.
I don't want any Vivian, or her look-alike in the magazine. I'll personally bury bullets between your eyes.
John gives Ryan a sign, let's get out of here.
John is about to exit, but stops and turns around.
John, I want you guys to find out who they are, and give all the information to Ryan.
John gives Ryan a sign. Ryan takes out his card and gives Jake the card.
Jake takes the card.
John and Ryan exit. EXT Notre Dame Cathedral, sunset. An established shot of Notre Dame Church in a sunset.
Hint.
Notre Dame Cathedral, sunset. Florent and Vivian walk down the aisle while conversing.
Vivian, do you believe in God?
Florent, my grandfather used to say if you know God more than the devil, you'll suffer a little. If the devil knows you more than you know yourself, you're in big trouble.
I believe in God for a selfish reason.
God promises you eternal life.
Vivian, that's interesting.
But let's break it down.
If you know God more than the devil, you'll suffer a little. What does that mean?
Florent, I don't know, my grandfather was an artist. He might be talking about his angels and demons that were keeping him at bay.
Don't seek pleasure through Satan, but rejoices with the truth.
Vivian, I see.
What about if the devil knows you more than you know yourself, you're in big trouble.
Florent, it means don't yield to temptation.
Love conquers all.
However, you can't separate love with temptation.
It's temptation and seduction that give twist and mystery to love.
Vivian smiles in beauty.
They stop walking and stand face to face.
Vivian, anyway, this is our last day together.
Florent, why do you mean this is our last day?
Vivian, it's been almost 9 weeks.
They want me to wake up.
They missed me.
I can hear their voices in my head.
There is a silent moment.
Florent then.
Florent, so, what do you want to do the rest of the day?
Vivian, seductively by his lips surprise me.
They kiss French.
The people in the church look at them in wonder, isn't it taboo to kiss in the church?
On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously.
EXT Florent's Mercedes convertible, moving, day.
Florent and Vivian drive in the street of Paris.
Florent is behind the wheel.
Vivian is in the passenger seat.
EXT Art Expo, day.
It is the biggest art expo ever. We see all kinds of spectacular paintings in display, professional and amateur artists around the world, street painters, various wonderful artistic and abstract paintings by famous and new upcoming artists, national and international.
Florent and Vivian walk down in the middle of the expo.
Vivian is awestruck. She didn't know there are a lot of amazing artists throughout the world, but thinks none of them can compare with Florent. He is from a different planet where mothers give birth only to artists.
EXT Art Expo, painting section, day.
Florent and Vivian come up to a section where anybody can paint his and her own material.
They walk up to a painting canvas. Florent grabs a painting brush and tells her to paint whatever she likes. Vivian acts shy at first, but says what I have to lose. She takes the painting brush and begins to paint. It's an abstract painting. She is a very good painter. Florent looks at her with astonishment. Yet, Vivian feels she is nowhere close to Florent and asks him to finish the painting for her. Florent tells her to go ahead and finish it yourself. It's amazing. He takes her hand and helps her paint a little bit. He then lets her finish it by herself. We stay with Vivian, Florent, and the painting in fast forward. In the end, Vivian signs her name on the corner of the painting. Ext Seine River, bridge, sunset. Florent and Vivian take a walk in a bridge, conversing. They then stand lips to lips. They talk between soft kisses and kiss French. Int. Supermarket, night. Florent and Vivian shop. Vivian is inside the shopping cart, just having fun. Florent pushes the cart while placing all kinds of groceries in the cart. They are having the time of their lives. On the soundtrack, French music play melodiously. Int. Florent's villa, kitchen, night. Florent and Vivian cook while conversing. We don't hear what they are saying due to the music on the soundtrack. Florent says something romantic. Vivian smiles in beauty. She stops what she is doing and gets closer to Florent. They talk between soft kisses and begin to dance tango. They are very good. They do a couple of amazing moves. They then kiss French. Ext Florent's villa, garden, night. Sparkling stars. A cheerful moon, beautiful weather. Florent and Vivian, who is wearing a bewitching red Valentino gown, sit at a table placed in the middle of the garden while enjoying what they just cooked with glasses of wines. There are roses, and candles. We also see water fountain, sculptures, and firelight. Two swans are floating on the pond. It is romantic. Vivian, if you could have dinner with five notable people, who would it be? Florent, Audrey Hepburn, Marilyn Monroe, Marion Cotillard, Megan Fox, and Angelina Jolie. Vivian, you have excessive sexual drive. Florent, is that so? Vivian, Megan Fox is gorgeous. That's why you want to have dinner with her. Angelina is wild at heart. Marion Cotillard is sensual. Marilyn Monroe was a sex symbol. Florent, what about Audrey Hepburn? Is she as naughty as Marilyn Monroe? Vivian, she's sweetheart. Maybe you're a player. Florent, how is that? Vivian, you like to keep girls guess. Florent, humorously that is not true. Audrey Hepburn were super freak to her last heartbeat. She was just born in the wrong era. You know, if she had spent one night with me, the next day, she would turn into a porn star. Vivian, are you suggesting I should be a porn star? Florent, no. It was only a joke. Vivian, I knew it was a joke. I was just fucking with you. Florent, I get it. What about you? Who are five notable people you'd like to have dinner with? Vivian, Jesus Christ, George Clooney, Bob Marley, Leonardo DiCaprio, and Daniel Day-Lewis. Florent, why Jesus Christ? Vivian, he died for our sin. I am still sort of Christian. I believe God is a good-looking man. Florent smiles softly. Florent, what about Daniel Day-Lewis? Vivian, he won 3 Academy Awards, Play Christy Brown in My Left Foot 1989, Daniel Plainview in There Will Be Blood 2007, and Abraham Lincoln in Lincoln 2012. I respect people who are into art. Florent, that's interesting. But Confucius said, by 3 methods we may learn wisdom: first, by reflection, which is noblest; second, by imitation, which is easiest; and third, by experience, which is the bitterest. Vivian, what does that mean? Florent, what do you think it means? Vivian, I think it means you can look back and apply the knowledge that you learn in the past. You can copy other and get by for a while, or you change the course of the night with sexual intercourse. Florent smiles in wonder. Florent, it's pretty good. But that's better than what I had in mind. Vivian, what did you have in your mind? Florent, love at the lips was touch. As sweet as I could bear. And once that seemed too much. I lived on air. Vivian, that's something. Florent, it's a poem by Robert Frost. Vivian, I think I heard of it before. But do you have your original literature work? We may learn wisdom by imitation, which is easiest. But I want something authentic, seductive, and bittersweet. Florent smiles softly. He looks at her eyes tenderly. He then. Florent, you sowed passion in my heart with a single glance, a sudden look that I'll never forget as long as there is a thing called romance. I saw the sun and true love eclipsing on your face, and giving birth to my soul in a hidden dimension before infinity and time and space. Vivian smiles in beauty. Vivian, that's romantic. Florent, would you care for a dance? Florent gives her his hand to dance. She takes his hand. They get up, come up to the open floor, near the water fountain, and begin to dance slow. Vivian, you remember we were talking about Casablanca. Rick letting Ilse getting into the plane. Florent, what are you saying? Should Ilse have stayed with Rick even it meant Victor Laszlo would have left with a broken heart? Vivian, I just thought Isa couldn't live with herself. She loves Rick more than she loves Victor Laszlo. Florent, but the good guys would have lost the war without Victor Laszlo? Ilse ended the World War II. Vivian,
to hell with the war. True love comes first.
Florent, I agree with you. I think Rick should have watched Goodfellas, as far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster. As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be with her. For me to live without her is death.
Vivian, I love Goodfellas. It's one of my favorite movies of all time.
Florent, too much violence.
Vivian, I like the narration, how Henry tries to justify his action in voiceover. But it didn't really work on Casino. It sounds like a documentary.
Florent, can you imagine Casablanca in voiceover? How is Rick going to explain on letting Lisa go?
Vivian, maybe narration is not cracked up to be. It works for one movie. It doesn't work for another.
Florent, something can be done, imitating Rick in voiceover. I had to let her go. She's with a man, who believes in equality, justice, and freedom. And blah blah blah. Maybe he's fighting for a cause that's greater than myself. I wouldn't know. I stick my neck out for no one?
Maybe, he needs her more than I do.
I greatly doubt that. As much as I want to believe in liberty, fairness, perhaps a better future someday, and have stood against injustice all my life, I hate to see her leave regardless of what he's fighting for, what the Pope in Vatican City thinks about the war, and what they all are battling for, what the devil is up to, and if God cares or not. I need her to breathe. I need to live. I need her, so my heart can pump blood in my veins. My soul needs her to be saved, to seek salvation, to be completed. Perhaps, those stupid voices in my head tricked my heart. I gained a little consciousness out of so-called kindness at the last minutes. I turned my other cheek, whatever that means. I let her go against my soul's wish. But I swear once the war is over. I'll take that back. Maybe the war will never end. It might continue for a while. Maybe the Germans will win. We all might end up in concentration camps. Maybe the Alliance's force will win. Freedom will come to all. I don't care. Once I get my head straight. War. No war. I will track her down wherever she is. I will find her. I'll kiss her delicious lips with all my heart and soul as if my very existence pledged allegiance of love to them. I vow faithfulness to her sweet lips, which they stand, and two hearts beating under one love, inseparable, with loyalty and devotion only for her. I'll kiss her lips as if they were the cradle of passion that were intent to rule the universe and oversee the truth and the action of the cosmos. Something that has existed before everything. I'll kiss them as if they were covenant that were created before all flowers. I'll fall in love with her again and again, forever and ever, and for eternity and beyond. Rick then tracks her down in New York City. They kiss for long minutes without parting their lips. They then drive to Hollywood, stuffs that dreams are made of. She smiles in beauty.
Vivian, under her breath that's orgasmic. They kiss French.
Int. Florent's villa, bedroom, night. Florent and Vivian make love. It's steamy, seductive, and passionate. We stay with them with series cuts.
Int. Florent's villa, bedroom, morning. Florent is sleeping. He then opens his eyes and looks around. Vivian is not with him. He gets up and walks toward the living room.
Int. Florent's villa, studio, day. Florent comes up to Vivian's portrait that is covered with a blanket. He slowly removes the blanket from the portrait. Vivian has returned to the painting.
Florent thinks, could it all be a dream? He continues to gaze at her eyes. As he is about to turn around, Vivian gives him a wink.
Florent smiles at her softly and walks away.
Int. Saint Germain Hospital, Vivian's room, morning. Vivian sleeps in beauty. She opens her eyes. At the entrance, John walks in and looks at her.
EXT Saint Bridge, morning. A beautiful dawn. The sun has just risen.
Florent stands in the bridge looking at the Seine River. He is lost in thought. On the soundtrack, music plays melodiously.
Montage.
London, a quick take of the City of London, Tower Bridge and London Eye, City of London, Palace of Westminster, Buckingham Palace, Kew Gardens, Westminster Abbey, St. Margaret's Church, Piccadilly Circus, St. Paul's Cathedral, Tower Bridge and Trafalgar Square and others.
EXT Buckingham Palace, day.
An established shot of Buckingham Palace.
Int. Buckingham Palace, Vivian's room, day.
Vivian sits in a chair. She is wearing nothing but underwear and bra. Amanda applies a light makeup on Vivian's face as they get prepared for the wedding. We see Vivian wedding gown on the bed.
Amanda, you've never told me what happened between you and that artist.
Vivian, what artist?
Amanda, never mind. The doctor said you might suffer from amnesia.
Vivian, what artist are you talking about?
Amanda, we met this artist, Florent Raphael, at an art gallery in Paris.
You left with him.
I didn't hear from you for 3 days.
Then the accident happened.
You lost all your memories.
Vivian says nothing.
Amanda continues to apply makeup on Vivian.
There is a silent moment.
Vivian, anyway, I have a weird dream last night, posing nude for this artist.
It felt real.
Amanda, what happened?
Vivian, I don't remember, I mean I was naked. And I was extremely happy for some reason.
Vivian gets up, walks up to the bed, and picks up her wedding gown.
In the meantime, Amanda sees the rose and cupid tattoo on Vivian's skin.
Amanda, when did you get the tattoo?
It looks cute.
Vivian, what tattoo?
Amanda, the rose tattoo above your buttock. Vivian comes up to the mirror and looks at her tattoo in the mirror. Memories floods in her brain. Flashback, Vivian's memories. She remembers meeting Florent at his art show, how she got the tattoo at the tattoo shop. Florent doing Vivian's portraits. Florent and Vivian making out in the rain. Vivian and Florent dancing, etc. Back to, Vivian and Amanda. Vivian doesn't know what is going on. She drops her wedding gown. She had been with Florent while she was in coma. The portrait is a gate between dreams, fantasy, and reality. She looks at herself in the mirror. EXT Saint Bridge, day. Florent stands in the bridge, looking at the river. On the soundtrack, music continues to play. Hint. Westminster Abbey, John and Vivian's wedding, day. It is a royal wedding. We see hundreds of guests from a lot of countries, friends, and families. John, who is wearing a military uniform, Royal Navy, stands at the chapel. All Vivian's families are present. Close up, Vivian. She walks down the aisle, escorted by her father. Vivian comes up to John. John takes Vivian's hand. They stand in front of the priest. Priest, we're gathered here in the presence of these witnesses to join this man and this woman together in matrimony. The contract is a most solemn one and not to be entered into lightly, but thoughtfully and seriously with deep realization of its obligations and responsibilities. John looks at Vivian's eyes. She is lost in thought. Priest, join right hands. Vivian and John join right hands. Priest, repeat after me. I, John Albert Charles, take you Vivian Parker, to be my wife, my partner in life and my one true love. John, I, John Albert Charles, take you Vivian Parker, to be my wife, my partner in life and my one true love. Priest, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse. John, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse. Priest, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. John, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. Priest, to love and to cherish, from this day forward until death do us part. John, to love and to cherish, from this day forward until death do us part. Priest, I Vivian Parker take you John Albert Charles, to be my husband, my partner in life and my one true love. Vivian, I'm sorry. I can't do this. I have to go. Vivian drops the flowers that she was holding, and runs down the aisle. Everybody looks at her in shock like where she's going. John shows no emotion as if he knew it was coming. Close up, Vivian. She continues to run toward the exit. EXT airplane, flying, day. Airplane flies in the air. Hint. Airplane, flying, day. Vivian sits next to the window, looking through the glass. EXT Seine River, bridge, sunset. Florent continues to look at the river. Then. Out of nowhere appears Vivian in the bridge. She is wearing her wedding gown. Florent turns his eyes and looks at her surprised. Vivian runs toward him. Florent walks toward her. They cuddle and kiss passionately. Vivian, I love you. Florent, I love you too. Close up, Vivian and Florent. They kiss more passionately. The end. This audio file was created by Panopreter Basic. You can download it at www.panopreter.com.